Good morning, everyone. Welcome to the 17th meeting of the Net Zero Energy and Transport Committee for 2022, which this morning we are conducting in a hybrid format. At agenda item one, we have consideration of whether to take agenda items 6 and 7 in private. These items relate to the consideration of our two public evidence panels this morning. The first is on heat on buildings and the second on energy price increases. Do we agree to take these items in private? That is agreed. Thank you very much. Items 6 and 7 will be taken in private. Our first agenda item today is an evidence session in relation to our inquiry into the role of local government and its cross-sectoral partners in financing and delivering a Net Zero Scotland. We launched this inquiry in December to look into progress at local level in reaching national net zero targets. Today's session will explore how local government can work together with public and private sector partners to meet the ambitious targets set out in the Scottish Government's Heat in Buildings strategy. And we have four panellists this morning, three of whom are joining us in the committee room this morning. We have Theresa Bray, Chief Executive, Change Works, on behalf of the Existing Homes Alliance; Roger Curtis, Technical Research Manager, Historic Environment Scotland; Professor Janet Webb, UK Energy Research Centre; and Elaine Watterson, joining us remotely, Policy Manager, Scotland Energy Savings Trust. Good morning, everyone. Thank you very much for joining the committee meeting this morning. It's very much appreciated that you've given up your time to appear before the committee. We have approximately 75 minutes for this panel session, and we will move straight to questions. The first question I have relates to the Scottish Government's Heat in Buildings strategy. As you know, there is a target to retrofit and decarbonise 1 million domestic dwellings and up to 50,000 non-domestic buildings by 2030. Given your experience in your respective areas, what do you see as the main challenges that local authorities and delivery partners will face in meeting those targets, and how realistic do you think those 2030 targets are? And perhaps I could begin with Professor Janet Webb and then move to Roger Curtis and then Theresa Bray. Thank you.
Okay, thank you very much, and thank you for the opportunity to speak this morning. So most of what I'm going to say derives from a combination of research, evaluation of the Energy Efficient Scotland pilots, and also some related work on the development of district heating networks. So is it feasible? Are those targets feasible? I think they are very ambitious, but I also think that we need to be extremely ambitious given all of the climate science and the dire warnings that we're getting about the state of our life support system, which certainly worries me. So I think it has to be done effectively. I think in Scotland we have one important piece of the puzzle just about in place, but that needs to be moved forward at a very systematic and rapid rate. And that is the proposition to introduce a requirement on all of our local authorities for local heat and energy efficiency strategies on a comprehensive basis, every building, so that we know literally that we are all in it together, that every property owner, whether they are public or private or commercial, has to be involved in this programme. And if that is done properly, then it provides the means. I think it does provide the structure that we need. We saw in the pilot area developments of smaller area developments of local heat and energy efficiency strategies some of the difficulties of doing that effectively. I know my colleague Theresa Bray can speak more in detail, I'm sure, than we can, but we saw particularly, for example, the lack of technical expertise in local authorities at the moment and the necessity to have enough of that in local authorities, or very easily and directly and responsibly accessible, that they can be the intelligent agent and intermediary. Most of the local authorities that we interviewed, representatives we interviewed, really wanted at least some more technical proficiency in-house so that they could feel that they understood the significance of the data and its robustness or otherwise. A second area was just that. How do you get that data accessible on a shared basis? Good agreed data sharing protocols done centrally that all the local authorities can tap into. Lack of good data, particularly on the commercial sector buildings, small and medium enterprise building stock, which needs resolving. And then also the concern that the local authority officers who were in charge had that they couldn't get this centrally onto the agenda of senior management in their authority and council leaders. And that's why they would all say to us that it needs to be a statutory requirement. Perhaps I should stop there and let someone else have a go. Thank you.
Thank you very much. You raised a number of very important points there, which I'm sure we'll pick up on. Roger, if I could ask the same question of you, please.
So, thank you. So HESS has been involved in researching thermal upgrade options for traditional and historic properties since 2008. There is a briefing note that gives a bit more background to that. And I think we're fairly comfortable with a suite of technical measures to bring most pre-1919 or hard-to-treat properties, certainly to a band C from the EPC point of view. Hollywood Park Lodge, just across the road, is now an EPC band C without renewables, and we're hoping phase two will achieve a renewable intervention and an improvement in that EPC certificate. You're very welcome to look at that building after this session, if any of you have time, and I'll discuss with the clerk on that. In terms of materials and interventions, a significant opportunity for Scotland in terms of organic and grown materials conforming to what we now call the circular economy, and to some extent those principles have guided our material selection. I think where the barriers to the implementation that you have just mentioned is probably in skills and the supply chain going forward. We know that significant shortages of labour and contractors for the existing workload of baseline construction. We know that 50% of the construction activity is repair and maintenance, and we also know there's a significant backlog catalogued by the Scottish House Conditions Survey of repair shortcomings. We also know that you cannot address energy efficiency with a building that's not properly maintained, is coping poorly with the effects of climate change, which in most parts of Scotland is more rain, frankly, and more damage. So substandard buildings, not well maintained, are not able to be improved thermally. And secondly, the supply chain, the labour. The skills and the professional knowledge and understanding to specify repairs correctly is also an important factor, but probably more like number two. I'll probably stop there and we can perhaps revisit some of these issues as the committee wishes.
Absolutely. Thank you very much, Roger. And if I could ask the same question of Theresa, then I'll bring in Elaine Watterson, who's joining us online.
The targets are very ambitious, but I think one of the big advantages is that we have the strategy, which combines both regulation, which is going to be a key point in delivery, along with levels of support as well. It is technically feasible. We're not having to find any new technology, but organisationally it is going to be very challenging to deliver. I think one of the key things which we've got to recognise that it is take the 2030 targets. We're looking at an 8-year programme to do that. And fair number of the challenges is that we actually operate on a year-by-year structure, which actually undermines the delivery of an 8-year programme. For instance, for the Scottish Government does provide funding for the Energy Efficient Scotland area-based schemes to local authorities to help the feel poor, but though they've outlined how much money they're going to commit over time, it is a year-by-year allocation. And some of the troubles with being a year-by-year allocation is that actually it takes, we're still waiting for the allocation to come through for local authorities. ChangeWorks delivers 8 out of the 32 local authorities with the managing agent. But to get the programmes off the ground, to do procurement each year is a challenge, to build demand and things like that. But because they only get an annual settlement, they cannot plan ahead. And actually, most of these schemes, you don't build a road by saying, well, how many miles can we build from start to finish in a year? If you're going to do it similarly, yes, you could do one property quite quickly. But if you're planning total regeneration of sort of over half our stock needs energy efficiency measures, you've got to look to change the heating in great numbers. It takes much longer. We need to move to multi-year funding on that. There's a range of there's a need, sort of Jan mentioned, the need for political support is required. Certainly, a lot of local authorities have net zero plans, but they don't necessarily see that through to what it means they've got to get involved in the housing across their local authority. There needs to be better coordination, I think, between the Scottish Government, between COSLA and SOLAS, to actually say that this is a high priority. Because to deliver on the targets, it's got to be seen as a vital element there. It's probably not as obvious, the changes that are taking place, when you see, compare some of the street access changes, but it's vital that we actually strengthen those links between the different areas. I think there is going to be need for support for local authorities, for the national energy agencies. There is a real skills shortage right across the country in a whole range of skills. And it's not going to get any better, particularly with the shortage of a few people coming from Europe. But they're not those skills there. There's got to be a lot of transition of people there. And how can that be made easier for people, whether it's looking at draft job descriptions that can be used for everybody, thinking about training, sort of the retraining of the workforce. A lot of the workforce is there, but they need to be reskilled. How can that be made easier? How do you engage with Business Gateway to make it happen? So it's organisationally very challenging, and it's how we achieve that rather than thinking about the technological changes.
Thank you very much, Teresa. And if I could bring in Elaine Watterson on the same question, please.
Thank you. Just to echo what others have said, we think that Scotland has the right level of ambition. We think that, you know, the challenge is right if we are going to address the climate emergency, and that Scotland is addressing the climate change in a much more proportionate way than the other countries of the UK. But the key thing is that, you know, business as usual activity isn't going to cut it. The pace and scale of activity needs to be accelerated very, very, very significantly. To echo what Jan said, I think there is a lack of expertise in a lot of local authorities. And just to give an example, where expertise has been provided to local authorities, it's already making a big difference. So, for example, the Danish mentoring scheme has provided really helpful support to local authorities like West Dumbartonshire and Shetland Council. And it's meant that, for example, the Queen's Quay project in West Dumbartonshire, it enabled it to be designed a bit, built out to a really good standard. And it also helped Shetland to upgrade their existing network by advising on pipework specifications, etc. So where kind of expert support is provided, it really does make a difference, and we're going to need to see a lot more of that. And I think the other issue I would flag is really just that, you know, these are all additional responsibilities for local authorities, and they will need to be resourced effectively in order to be able to deliver them and make their appropriate contribution to climate change mitigation.
Thank you very much for those opening remarks. A number of issues have been highlighted. One issue that was alluded to, which I'd like to follow up on briefly, is the question of who will finance the transition towards the decarbonisation of heat. We've heard from local government, local authorities, that they simply don't have the resources in terms of financial budget for this. I know it's a huge question, but I wonder if the panel members could briefly touch on their thoughts about, have they seen good examples in a pilot scheme or any mechanisms whereby there is a feasible method of financing the transition and the heat and building strategy. Perhaps I could follow the same order of panellists as in the first questions, to start with Professor Webb, please.
Yeah. Okay, thank you. Well, one way, I think, and potentially an important and valuable way to have lower costs, apart from Teresa saying multi-year funding to the local authorities is necessary to keep this plan moving, because it has to be a delivery plan, not just a strategy which then gets filed somewhere. It can, as we know, happen in many areas. So one way forward with that financing and to bring costs down is to work on an area by area basis. I take my own example. There is a programme coming to my street, for instance, if I could hear that, at a set price with built-in advice and support and end-to-end hand-holding kind of process, then I think far more people would be willing to pay and contribute and also to see that there are savings based on bulk procurement from that process, and where we were talking briefly before about the potential for a series of housing archetypes, for instance, which would also help to plan on an area-by-area basis. It also serves the function of public engagement at the same time, because when I talk to colleagues and friends about the Heat in Building Scotland programme, Energy Efficient Scotland, all of which have been around for the best part of 10 years now, many people still are not aware that they need to get going. So all of this becomes part of that engagement strategy and awareness raising. Of course, people could opt out, property owners could opt out, but then the regulation comes in behind to make sure that they do act. I think on an interesting possible route to financing those in homes who are in that considered self-funding category. Well, some element of grant is always helpful, as we know, because it makes people feel that they are being directly supported and incentivised, has to be backed by regulation all the time. But the other, another way forward, for instance, which I think there was some consideration of, certainly a couple of years ago in Scotland, was to look at the use of local savings and loan, in our case, the credit union networks, as a way to provide very affordable finance, low interest, with a Scottish Government guarantor as backing in case any of those loans are not repaid. But the evidence from European comparators suggests that this has worked pretty well, that there has been very low default in other parts of Europe. And then with the commercial sector, I think what we've seen, for instance, certainly with some of the research I've looked at on private sector landlords, and they can be for domestic or non-domestic, reputation matters. So in the Australian scheme, the Neighbours scheme, which I forget what it stands for, that acronym, but basically what was done was to pull, using the industry standards, to pull standards up by requiring property owners, commercial property owners, to advertise and to make clear that the energy performance of their building was at a very high standard, so there were advantages to taking a lease with them as opposed to another property company. And then for many commercial landlords, of course, they will act on the basis of regulation because they see the regulation coming. We've seen this with the minimum energy efficiency standards in the private rental sector for domestic tenants, that landlords will act on the basis that they know this is coming in, therefore they have to comply. And they can typically arrange the finance for that, it seems. And mostly those landlords, of course, there will be some who will try to avoid, but by and large, compliance, certainly from the bigger landlords, will be in place. There's a need for, I think, mop-up behind that, inevitably, with amounts of public funding. But generally, I think, you know, we've seen in other countries, certainly, that relatively small amounts of public funding bring in larger amounts of private funding behind it. Again, perhaps I should...
Yeah, no, thank you very much for those insights. A number of good points you made there. Perhaps I could bring in the other panel members. And I guess just following up some of those points, if there is more understanding in the marketplace eventually that homeowners will have to expense this from largely from their own sources, will this perhaps have an impact on house prices or buildings prices over time? Roger, given your experience in that sector, maybe that's something you can touch on in your remarks. Over to you.
Yeah, thank you. The financial landscape is not really my area, but I've picked up several sniffs, and I'd like to support Professor Webb's comment about area-based schemes where you're limiting the typologies, therefore the sort of the technical variation is less, you've got scales of product, of procurement, etc. We know that the retail finance sector is looking at the refurbishment space. We've been approached by a start-up with respect to financing for this sort of work. So the financial sector is looking at this, and I think there could be a little bit more work done or investigations done by people better versed than me on how much of that it could cover. I think, as was mentioned, this is going to be quite a broad mix with a selection depending on the circumstances of the home dwellers in a certain area. So I think I'll probably stop there. It's not my lead area. Interestingly, what is assumed to be the standard retrofit cost per housing unit varies quite a bit depending on what you talk to, but certainly private finance would put this in the region of 20k. It's that sort of figure, which is a little higher than several planning assumptions I've seen per housing unit.
Thank you very much, Roger. And Theresa, same question, please.
I think one of the key is going to be that we make sure we get information out there. Sort of, it's going to be very important, whether it's a public information campaign, something to see what's happening. Regulation is going to be vital, because if people will then start factor it in to think, when I come to sell my property, there are already indications that the market is factoring in the cost for that. And if you've got a low energy efficiency probably a better example, if you've already installed air source heat pumps in, particularly in off-gas areas, it does have an impact on price. So you may see the prices coming down where you have low energy efficiency, but that is probably beneficial, because to a large extent, if you start thinking these are works that needed to do it, so people who are buying it, the trouble with the property market at the moment is just become so unaffordable for the vast majority of the population, particularly young people, so having a bit of an impact on property prices if you're going to then result in better homes long term. Because our homes are often here for the long term. Sort of people are often living in homes that are 100 years old, so temporary blip in the property market would probably be useful there. There is huge amounts of private finance that's looking for a home in low carbon areas, but they are wanting to aggregate that demand. And that's one of the real issues, that they're not interested in loaning £10,000 or £20,000. They're into the hundreds of millions of pounds, whether it's pension funds or long-term investors. They want to shift away from the high energy intensive industries to something that gives a good return. And energy efficiency does give good return if you can make those financial models work. So aggregation is going to be vital, which is why you've got to start looking at, I know that Edinburgh is already considering, how could you aggregate that demand to actually have that area-based approach? So you are spending hundreds of millions of pounds or £1 billion to make that happen. Resource funding is required to actually lever in that private finance, to actually get those creative minds together to think, how can you create a model that will give the return to that? Similarly, we've looked with our tenemental stock, that has all been retrofitted already with electricity and gas. We're going to have to retrofit it with heat. But what model is going to supply that? Is it going to be the current utility companies, or is the opportunity for new business models probably a public-private partnership, which could then lever in large amounts of money to actually change the heating source there? And whilst you're putting the heating in as well, you address the energy efficiency at the same time and bundle it up into a single package. So as you pay for heat, you're paying for your energy efficiency measures. But there has got to be that resource funding to say, the economic minds to see, how do you create these models for the future, for a country? So we look to see how heat it's been done in Denmark and countries where they do have district heating throughout. A lot of those are owned by local municipalities. If something like that did, we need to design some structures so that it can be replicated across the country. So I don't think there's an issue with the overall capital, but it's how do you get access to that? There will be a role for some grant funding for the fuel poor, and also as to encourage the early adopters, but the state can't pay for everything.
Thank you very much for those insights, Theresa. And if I can bring in Elaine Waterson on the same question, please.
Yeah, as Theresa just said, the public purse can't foot the full bill. But I think it's important that we ensure that costs are fairly distributed and financed in a way that people that are less able to pay or that are vulnerable can access public financing, while self-funders have suitable, attractive financial propositions that can support the level of investment required. Area where we think there could be some merit in looking more at is the role of on-bill financing. So this approach is already being used in some parts of Europe already. For example, within the social housing sector in Netherlands, the Energiesprong model works by replacing the bill that residents would have paid to energy companies with an energy plan that costs no more than the householder to the householder than the bill that they would have previously paid to the utility. So the energy plan would be paid to the housing provider. We think that there could be real merit in looking at that kind of model for Scotland. I think it's maybe also worthwhile noting that to some extent, private funds are already levered in Scotland through the use of Scottish Government loans for energy efficiency and low carbon heating technologies, in that Scottish Government provides a loan, but that is paid back by the householder themselves.
Thank you very much, Elena. Thank you to our panel for those opening remarks. I wanted to bring in everyone to address some of those wider questions in terms of setting the scene. We might not have time to bring in all panel members for all individual questions members have, but let me now bring in Fiona Hislop, please. Fiona.
Thank you, and thank you for joining us. And I want to further look at the place-based approach. Clearly, there is evidence that a place-based approach could help. We've heard already in terms of area-based schemes. Our inquiries about local authorities, and I don't think anybody in that last session mentioned local authorities in relation to the place-based approach, although primarily we're looking at owner-occupier in that discussion. So I'd like to ask what changes would be needed from your perspective for local authorities to be involved in a place-based approach, both in public and private sector, and actually whether for the private owner-occupier that might be best left to a new vehicle that we've heard referred to in those last answers. So can I perhaps bring in Jeanette Webb for that one, and then maybe Theresa after that.
Thank you. So I think I was assuming that local authorities, when I mentioned area-based schemes, I was assuming local authorities would be instrumental in identifying those areas and doing the costing and prioritisation through the LHEs, the Heat and Energy Efficiency Strategy, for their area, and that they would be part of a coordination body, certainly, so that, of course, then you'd need probably different customised plans in place in different areas. Well, we would in Scotland. But that without that, I mean, we've seen in the evidence from our own research, as well as similar sorts of research, that local authorities generally tend to be trusted intermediaries by the different parties. For instance, at present, in the Green Homes Grant Local Authority Delivery Scheme in England, the SMEs who were involved in those, these were not as area-based as they should have been probably, but in those earlier trials of the local authority delivery scheme, the SMEs really appreciated the involvement of the local authorities, because they said, "Ah, yes, we get a good account, a good contract. It runs well, and we get paid, and we like that. And we've worked well together with the local authorities." So that was generally very positive from the evaluation that was done of that scheme. No real negatives coming back from the trade side who'd been involved. And on the household side, similarly, they said that they found the information coming from the local authority, the fact that it was backed by a local authority, helpful. It got them involved. It made them think this was a valid and legitimate scheme. So they went ahead and did it. And they were pleased with the results. Again, it's very unlike the Green Homes Grant voucher element of that programme, the local authority delivery aspect worked really well, and some of these houses were self-funding.
Theresa Bree. Thank you, Professor. Theresa Bree.
I think local authorities do have a vital role. They have an understanding of their communities, and they have their understanding of the physical stock and the restrictions. Like Jan mentioned, the local heat and energy efficiency strategies, it's going to be key that there is full ownership of these. I think one of the dangers sometimes can be that these are seen as technical documents, but they have to be owned because they will by the local authorities. I think local authorities do have a key role in building partnerships and coordination. If we're looking at some of the management of area-based schemes that we do on behalf of the local authorities, they very much have ownership. We come there and we are, in ChangeWorks, we're managing the contractors and that liaison with the householders. But it's still the reporting comes through to the housing the local authority. They are prioritising, they think, how they tie in both of their stock with the owner-occupier. So it's the oversight that's required and how it fits in with their priorities. they might not need the technical skills to actually have a clerk of works out on site, but they need to have an ownership of it at a policy level and an actual strategic delivery level. Improvements that's needed, I think that there's a lack of skills there. There's a lack of resource funding for it. I think that's key. I know that resource funding has been looking at to look at that. And there needs to be that recognition that it is not just doesn't fall to a single local authority officer. There's got to be more senior management ownership and the political will falling through. Some of the delivery there that you've put into other departments such as procurement and planning and areas like that, and those services need to be adequately resourced to deliver with that. It's because you could easily hold up a project if you haven't got sufficient procurement officers because there are only half a dozen there. Local authorities also need the support to think some of the areas I mentioned, such as district heating. How can they, I think they are likely to have a key role in partial ownership, and how can that be structured? You need to put in some, whether it's Scotland-wide consultancy support, to support different models for different local authorities. It's all part of the planning to take place with it. They don't have the skills there, and they don't have the ability to access the technical skills either. What frameworks do you put in place to actually for the local authorities to have a key role in that strategic delivery?
Thank you. And I can maybe move to Elaine Waterson. And clearly owner-occupiers and those not in fuel poverty are expected to be proactive in seeking decarbonising information, advice and support. But if we are to approach this on a zoning or street-by-street or place-based approach, what would the role of local authorities be or could be in that kind of area-placed approach? And how do we kind of unlock and stimulate that collective action? Are you unmuted, Elaine?
Sorry, I think I'm unmuted now. Can you hear me?
Yes, I can.
Okay, I think local heat and energy efficiency strategies will have a key role here because it will be that information that will allow people to know what the most appropriate heating source is for their property. So are they in an area that is likely to be served by a district heating network? Are they potentially in one of the small areas that might be served by hydrogen, or is the solution electrification? And in which case, you know, is that a heat pump or is that direct electric heating? So I think the local heat and energy efficiency strategies will be key from that perspective and ensure that people make the right decisions about how to heat their homes.
And finally, if I can come to Roger Curtis and to get your perspective on area-based approach and how that might happen in obviously pre-19 properties, many of which might be owner-occupiers, what could the role of Historic Environment Scotland be in supporting area-based approaches? And perhaps you might be aware there's some myths that seem to think that Historic Environment Scotland are somehow an inhibitor for change, particularly around windows, for example, rather than enablers. And I'll also give you opportunity to reflect on what does the draft NPF4 mean in terms of conservation or indeed celebration of our heritage in a dynamic way for Historic Environment Scotland going forward. Quite a big area, but it'd be interesting in your view.
I think in terms of the area schemes, very happy to lead. I think we're already doing that, leaning in on specific typologies in certain areas. Absolutely support the role of the local authority. We're working with the City of Glasgow Council on a couple of pilot projects on the south side of the town there. And I think we can offer an element of technical reassurance on some things and give support the typology model. Local authorities have a very good granular understanding of the local area, the services, the routes, the access, and the strategic plan that Elaine mentioned. In terms of fabric and options for improvement, I think we've identified that virtually every building, in fact every building, can be improved substantially. We've generated significant savings even in what you might call highly protected structures, and for the percentage of listed properties in Scotland, which is around 3%, nearly all of those can be improved to within very close to the standard. noting the overall consideration of embodied carbon and things like that. The recent the HES recently issued Green Recovery Statement, which is about the role of the existing and historic environment being a catalyst for wider improvements in society, be it community, be it aesthetic, well-being, and sense of place, which are core to our identity. As has been noticed, some of our town centres, the density of older buildings is much, much higher. So in fact, there is a very big focus, particularly on tenements. And I think certain technologies are suited better. So we were talking earlier about district schemes as being very suitable for the tenement typology of many age bands as well. So I think different things suit different property types. We would certainly see ourselves as supporting that work, be it with direct advice to local authorities, smoothing the path with respect to consents and some of the other statutory applications, and actually noting that an improved existing housing stock is going to be a massive part of the problem. So I think we're sort of standing by to support and offer in. We've published quite extensively on this, and many reports coming out give that in the shorter term, because that's where the carbon savings are needed now, it's that domestic level improvement in the next 10 to 15 years is the one which we really need to aim for, even though we know we're planning for a 60, 70 year lifetime of some of these interventions. Did that catch all the points? I'm not sure if
also, somebody else might ask about Historic Environment Scotland's view on double glazing or triple glazing in historic buildings.
Yeah, no, on the window side, we're pretty comfortable with advanced glass in various options. Looking at the circular economy, embodied carbon, and the wider carbon story of construction materials and how that is used, there is a discussion about what those materials could be. But in terms of windows performance with better performing products, particularly glass, we can fit that in, we can make that happen. Again, it's horses for courses and different options, but we're fairly comfortable with that. So I wouldn't see that as a barrier at all.
And I think on NPF4, convener, it might be helpful if HES, Historic Environment Scotland, wrote to the committee about your views on NPF4 from a conservation point of view, because we've got a wider interest in that. But I think we'll probably have to move on in terms of questions just now, if that's okay with you. Convener.
Great. Thank you very much, Fiona. Let me bring in Monica Lennon now, who is joining us online. Monica, over to you, please. Monica, you're not. You're still on mute, I think.
I think I have been unmuted.
Yep.
No. Okay. Good morning, everyone. We've heard some evidence today about the key barriers that local authorities face when trying to maximise their involvement and success in making homes warm, healthy and aligned with net zero. Professor Webb's already talked about a lack of technical expertise, and I just wonder what kind of expertise are local authorities having to buy in because of that, and what are the areas of skills and expertise that we really need to see advanced for Scotland? Maybe come to Professor Webb on that initially.
Sorry, was that me? Yeah.
Professor Webb?
Yeah, sorry. Yeah. So the skills and expertise that are needed in local authorities, by local authorities, yeah? So I would say primarily, I can give perhaps a particular example would help. One, for instance, that we have looked at was the use of European Union technical assistance funds by a number of local authorities and also by Welsh Government. That was the ELENA fund, particularly the European Local Energy Assistance Fund. To create, and what happened there was local authorities, or indeed Welsh Government, would receive funding through the European Investment Bank, in this case, to develop an in-house team to understand how to plan and implement local energy developments and how to cost that and so on. So they were getting a significant group of people together for the first time as an in-house team. And we found there were quite strong strings attached to that funding. So I think it was 1 in 20. So for every euro that was given in grant, the recipient had to guarantee that they would get 20 euros back in commercial or other matched investment. And in fact, what we found just in the ALENA schemes that had been used in British local authorities, I don't think we had any of these in Scotland, they were in England and one in Wales, that for every euro that came in technical assistance funding to those local authority teams, 37 euros came back in terms of investment into local energy initiatives. So that was a really effective use of public funding to bring in a much bigger volume of commercial funding around district energy developments. In Scotland, for instance, we now have that 300 million commitment to green heat network developments. That could be used in a similar way, I would have thought, to create those sorts of technical assistance teams that would then plan and start to develop district heating networks in the areas that we've heard others mention. For example, we know that in areas of central Edinburgh, the University of Edinburgh itself already has some heat network developments and is trying to plan for a future without gas CHP on that heat network technologies. So we need that kind of technical assistance to be in place at urban scale in centres where heat networks look typically to be an effective solution to decarbonising heat, with, of course, the need to capture waste heat and unused heat from industry and secondary sources, as well as having big-scale heat pumps or potentially, in some areas of Scotland in future, hydrogen as a heat network source as well. I don't know if that's going far enough or...
Yeah, thank you, Professor Webb. I was just referring back to my notes because you had said that there's a lack of technical expertise in local authorities and that there needs to be more technical proficiency in-house. So as a committee, we hope to make recommendations to Scottish Government, to local government as well. So based on what you've just said, what would you recommend needs to happen in terms of action to address that technical expertise challenge that you've mentioned?
I think, well, what we found when we interviewed the local authority officers involved in the year-on-year area-based schemes and Energy Efficient Scotland pilots was that they said to do this work more systematically and on a more, on a planned and strategic basis, that most local authorities were looking for at least one, if not two, full-time equivalent members of staff to enable that work to go ahead. And of course, you could suggest that in some of the smaller authorities, there might well be a shared resource. That's, I think, where the proposals for a public energy agency in Scotland come in. That needs to be coordinated. That planning needs to be coordinated between that national agency and the local authorities, I would suggest, so that we could see, well, what will work most effectively? Could some of those technical resources be shared? How would that work? Would you put authorities together in an area where that made sense? For instance, an area that I'm reasonably familiar with, Greater Glasgow and Clyde, I know that officers who've worked there over a fairly long period on the potential for district heating network developments have said that it doesn't make sense to have those strict geographical boundaries of one council area or another council area, but to plan across areas to optimise the economies of scale and to connect up as many properties as possible. So there has to be obviously a degree of flexibility, but certainly needs that investment in our local authorities.
Thank you, Professor Webb. I wonder if Roger Curtis wants to add anything in terms of technical expertise within local authorities.
No, thank you. I'd support Professor Webb in the sort of the scale of support at an organisational level, but I think quite quickly they'll default to the ability of contractors and trades to deliver the work on the ground, because that's under pressure already with the existing schemes at the present levels, including at the basic repair and maintenance level. And with that trade requirement goes the qualifications that those installers will need to have. And at the moment, that's, I would suggest, under capacity. There are not many installation training schemes running in Scotland at the moment. We've got a package we're running, which we hope local authority further education colleges will take out. That's a course in retrofit for pre-99 and traditional buildings. And we can't train Scotland, much though we'd like to, or we'd be happy to do so with resourcing, but this needs to be national. Every FE college needs to train up a cohort of installers so that the local authorities have got levers they can move. Certainly the feedback from Glasgow as of last week is that when we put something to tender, we're not sure what's going to come back. And if it comes back, is it going to be September, October, November, whatever? So I think that the industry capacity for retrofit, whichever flavour of retrofit you're talking about, whether it's the older stuff or the more recent post-war, that there is a real capacity gap and there's an education and training gap. And I think those are pretty fundamental for delivery at area level.
It's really interesting, Roger. When you mentioned resources, what did you mean? Are there not enough resources to meet the demands of training places?
At the moment, there aren't enough contractors going around doing the work as it is. You talk to anyone, whether it's new build, whether it's refurbishment, or indeed thermal and energy upgrade, they are waiting for the construction sector. The construction are rushed off their feet. And it's that capacity question I'm mentioning. Yes, there is a local authority organisational capacity and understanding the question capacity shortfall, but the scale of that, I think, is probably more modest. It's the actual delivery at scale by contractors. And indeed, the professionals, the architects, surveyors, and designers and specifiers, but the numbers are a wee bit smaller there. I would suggest it's the actual folk on the ground doing the installation work and the qualifications that need to go with that.
Thank you. In the interest of time, I think I'll need to move on to the next question, which has been covered earlier on by Theresa Bray, and that was the issue about multi-year funding. So I just wondered, Theresa, you talked about the current approach with annual settlements and it makes it hard to plan ahead. So is it your recommendation that there should be multi-year funding models for local government? Is that what you were meaning?
It's vital there's multi-year funding for the allocation of the area-based schemes. Already there are indications given, but it has to be a contractual agreement so that the local authority then is able to enter into contracts and plan the work ahead. It just does not work having single year funding. It's something we've been asking for, and yes, they've been for a lot, the existing homes been asking for many years, but it has got to be put in place. It may be that you cannot guarantee for each local authority that they're, say, currently receiving £3 million per year, and it might not be that you're able to guarantee £3 million for each year, but if you were to guarantee £3 million for the current year, £1.5 million for the following year, and say £500,000 for the year ahead, and then that get reviewed each year, that certainty would make a huge difference to what they're able to deliver. They would then, sort of briefly picking up on your earlier point, they need to have some skilled project managers with both technical project management and organisational management. That often those people are pulled in all directions, but for managing these sorts of projects and to be more creative, there needs to be some people to be able to see it through, to manage it through the structures as well within a local authority. And the resources are needed in the procurement and building standards and the like. But multi-year funding is key for any of this, because these projects are not going to be completed in a year. If you're going to have area-based schemes, you will expect to be in an area, for say, for the self-funded, for 5 to 10 years, for people to be in the right position to take action in their homes. So it is a long-term project we've got to be. You don't move forward from 6 months in one area and 6 months in another. It's got to be a long-term approach for these areas.
That's really helpful, Theresa. Thank you. You also talked about the importance of political will and, I think, buy-in from senior management within local authority. What would help to achieve that? Are you aware of examples in any local authority in Scotland where there's good visibility, perhaps a committee on net zero or should there be more net zero committees like the one we have here in Parliament? And what would help in terms of the way administrations organise themselves? Because I think this week is when they vote on who's in charge of what committee. What would help to make sure that there is that joined up approach and a real strategic approach within each local authority?
The often local authorities will have a net zero committee or task force, but particularly if they still own their own housing stock, there can be then that divergence between the responsibility for housing, which has got a key delivery for, if you look for the where a local authority can influence things, a quarter of the emissions are from heating, sort of if you exclude industry there. So there is that thought about, well, what model, how do you coordinate the housing and the zero carbon committee? That housing is often seen as the poor relation, and how do you bring that in? In ways, some of the local authorities, I think particularly say in the Borders Council, which doesn't own its own housing, has actually had to be more creative because they don't have the skills in-house and the understanding of the housing stock able to move forward. But that there is force of circumstances, and they've started to have to think wide about how you tie in the local college and skills development as well, because they don't, their levers have had to be more on partnership than delivery because they don't own their housing stock. So they've got to be their models to think, well, how do you, the team that's responsible for housing all the way up the chain, how does that then say talk to corporate strategy? It is, we've seen within Edinburgh, ChangeWorks does deliver, I sit on the Edinburgh Climate Commission, but we're also, ChangeWorks, we deliver work for the housing committee. It's how do you get those areas to tie in? And often it is, I think, that middle to senior management have got, who are often very overstretched, to see that they have got a role in all their delivery, in delivering net zero. So it's exemplifying what opportunities there are, sort of sample guides for responsibility could help. How procurement can stop things happening. That's often one of the issues with local authorities, because they are, by nature, have been forced to be quite risk-averse. And so that, how do you get all the procurement colleagues together across Scotland to be much more creative in their delivery? Similar with planning, they have their own responsibilities. How could planning be much more creative to think what could be done? So it is that sharing of good practice and engagement. The small team working in a local authority often gets quite isolated. And how do you get that coordination taking place and to bring those new ideas into those functions, which is driven at a senior management level?
That's all really helpful, thank you. Before I pass back to convener, I haven't heard from Elaine Waterston. Elaine, do you want to add anything to that?
I don't have anything to add to that, thank you.
Okay, thank you. Back to you, convener.
Thank you very much, Monica. Next up is Liam Kerr, to be followed by Mark Ruskell. Liam, over to you, please.
Thank you, convener. Good morning, panel. To get into a couple of specific questions, I'd like to go back to a question that the convener asked, which, Theresa Bray, you responded to. Roger Curtis talked about spending £20,000 to retrofit, being a rough cost of retrofitting a property. And Theresa Bray followed that by saying, well, if you don't do that, then conceded the convener's point that there could be a drop in house price, and suggested that a blip in the property market would be beneficial. I would counter, perhaps, that it wouldn't be beneficial for those who have bought their house but don't have £20,000 or perhaps the time to retrofit and end up in things like negative equity. How really can people in that situation be persuaded to retrofit?
I think that when point of sale occurs, there's got to be the opportunity to pass it on to the person buying the house, because they may not have the opportunity to do that. So that there's that opportunity within regulations required to pass on the obligation. There will be a need for long-term planning to take place, so people are seeing this forward. And one of the issues can be that if we're talking about the people who are struggling, the fuel poor, that is going to need grant funding. We are seeing significant amounts of public funding putting in, and that can make huge difference to the area, particularly if you're carrying out external wall insulation projects, and that all households make some contribution to that. and the loan funding is provided, and it's often a relatively low level, sort of up to £1,000 that is repayable over 10 years, is often seen as something that is achievable there. So it is those households, because that can really improve both the money they're saving on their fuel. It will be more difficult to think for those people who find themselves in negative equity and don't have the money to invest in their homes. And yes, that's where grant funding will come in. But part of the stuff is if people start planning ahead, that's sort of when you start having, they will have to prioritise looking at the heating and the energy efficiency rather than new bathrooms and kitchens, which is often one of the debates, which is not the poorest that we're talking about, or those possibly the people you're thinking about, but their householders will be required to make those difference, to make their buildings suitable for the future, and to accept that their different forms of heating will be required. There's going to be needs. It's difficult conversations that's going to be had with people if we're going to do that, and that is political leadership is going to be required on that.
Is going to be a difficult conversation. Elaine Waterson, we heard in that response that Theresa Bray talked about loan funding. Now, the Energy Saving Trust delivers the Home Energy Scotland programme for the Scottish Government. And your last annual report highlights interest-free loan funding is available of £38,500 to owners and landlords to help with energy efficiency and installations. Now, I think the total given out that year, so 2021, of that report was to just under 1,300 properties. There are around 1.9 million private properties in Scotland. So it begs the question, is the Home Energy Scotland funding sufficient? Why is take-up so low, and how can it be increased?
You're absolutely right. If you look at existing take-up against what take-up will need to be if Scottish Government targets are going to be met, that there is a massive, massive gap. And that kind of goes back to the point that I was making earlier. We really need an absolutely massive increase in the pace and scale of activity. Whether Scottish Government funding is enough, I think on that, I think as we said before, we need more private investment to come in. The public purse can't pay for everything. And I think that's where, for example, the role of the Green Heat Task Force or the Green Finance Task Force will play a big role in terms of identifying how lots of this can be financed. I think in terms of creating the necessary levels of demand, we need to see, as others have said earlier, we need to see regulation. People need to know exactly what needs to happen to their homes by what date, so that they can plan for these. So they can plan for these changes.
Thank you. Final question from me, convener, please. I'll go back to Theresa Bray for me, because there was a recent report by the Existing Homes Alliance, which suggests that people are concerned. I'm paraphrasing, so correct me if I'm reflecting wrongly. But that people are concerned that if they put in, let's say, a heat pump, that they will then see a district heating system coming down the track and think, well, you know, I've invested £20,000 and what I'm getting, you know, I could have waited. So as a result, people are reticent about making that investment. If that's right, if that is a correct reflection of your report, how can those uncertainties be addressed, and do you see a role for local authorities in that?
Yeah. Local authorities have a vital role through their local heat and energy efficiency strategy. It needs to go down to the detail of saying we're going to be zoning these areas for district heating, but these properties we're expecting alternative approaches for decarbonisation of heat. People can take a guess at the moment. If you live in a tenement, probably that's going to require district heating. But it's much more difficult on the edges. But that we need that clarity and as soon as possible, because it is making people delay decisions. And maybe there could be some broader indications given, so that if you're living in a relatively small village, they make clear that there's unlikely to be district heating for that to progress. But I guess partly what is the role of new build, but the clarity that local authorities can provide on that. And in ways, it's more important for that information to be there rather than it to be totally always optimum, because there's always this danger that you could wait for more information before making a decision. And the difficulty with that, if you delay the decisions, it's going to be costing you more, and it's going to be costing people more to heat their homes, and you're better to make a decision rather than wait another 5-10 years to see what comes down the road, because it will be costing householders more if you don't.
Thank you. No further questions.
Thank you very much. Liam, let me bring in Mark Ruskell to be followed by Jackie Dunbar. Mark, over to you, please.
Yeah, thanks, Convener. I just wanted to just briefly go back on comments that you made, Jeanette, around street-by-street, area-by-area schemes. I mean, it feels like we've been talking about this now for a long time. There was the example, I think, 15 years ago of Kirklees Council successfully doing this. What is actually getting in the way of delivery? Because I am seeing rollout through energy company obligation of some area-by-area schemes, but I'm not seeing that extended to owner-occupiers within communities. So what is the barrier to moving at pace and at scale on that street-by-street basis, and how are the LHEs going to deal with that? If I could start with yourself, and then I'll maybe go to Theresa.
Yeah, I think partly it's that wait-and-see question that we've had some discussion of, that the LHEs, those strategies and delivery plans, are not yet perceived, at least, to be in place, even though I know many local authorities would say they know pretty much what's what and how to proceed. But there's still this sense of, oh, but we're not quite there yet, and so we're not sure about this. And also I think the lack of certainty in other areas, including the things that Theresa has talked about around year-on-year financing, often officials in local authorities being on year-to-year contracts as well and not being clear about whether they will be in charge of how this is done in future, not having that political leadership behind them, perhaps. I know that in councils where this has worked better, what we've typically seen is that the finance team, the chief exec's office, the spatial planning team, and the net zero or climate change team are all well aligned and in agreement, and they've got that political leadership at the front saying, right, we're going to go with this. So I think sometimes it's that the divisions within council structures and the fact that council officers are having to rely on the goodwill of colleagues, which I have to say is in, I think, reasonably short supply at present because of the pressures on everyone in public sector roles and commercial sector to do lots of work in a very compacted time. So it needs that. We also need the financial piece to be there to encourage that area by area basis. So I'm not aware, for instance, I live in Edinburgh, I own a house in Edinburgh. I'm not aware that Edinburgh Council is in a position to make an area by area offer to those of us in our own properties who can afford to pay the costs of that or would look to borrow some of it, perhaps. But it's that systematic process, and again, the difficulties that colleagues have alluded to over finding traders. I think that's the importance of an area-by-area-based scheme, but we don't yet have that critical mass of contractors ready to pick up that work, though the evidence from other areas is that works well, because then those, particularly if it's SMEs, they get a body of work at once, which enables them to plan and do it most effectively.
Okay, Theresa, can I bring you in on this?
There are a number of issues there. I think that there has to be the demand, and local authorities should be saying that we need to have these services in place, and by outlining it, because it isn't going to happen without it being clearly articulating that demand. That we do recognise, if you look within Edinburgh, there's often been there's partnerships been issued there. There are the seeds of looking to see how the development's taking place. They're particularly where they're looking at where they've got multi-occupancy properties, where there's been right to buys taking place in four and a block and the like. They are looking to see what support can be provided. But actually, that's not probably the majority of the stock, that you have got huge swathes where you've got large numbers of people who are going to be self-funded. And it's that's almost stating we need to have sufficient support. And I think that's one of the issues. Home Energy Scotland has got a role in providing advice. But for actually things to happen practically on the ground, there's need for articulating what that is, and it is sort of going through that people need support to find traders, often looking at joint purchasing can take place on an area based. There is a need for assistance with specification, for quality control, and most importantly, often for post-installation support, because if you have shoddy works taking place, they need to be rectified, and if you're putting new types of heating systems in, people need to know how to use it. So there's a need for a full, whether it's a retrofit agency. Often these have been driven in somewhere like Manchester, where it has been a carbon co-op has developed. So it's small, individual, sort of third sector organisations, but that is probably not sufficient to drive the level of schemes where you're going to need this level of support taking place throughout the country. It may well be that at a city like Edinburgh, yes, you can go for a single, where you've got a tight geographical hub, that you could have a central agency with people going out to support it. But if somewhere like Highlands, where it's a very different nature, actually you're not going to get that support all provided out of Inverness. You're going to have much more locally dispersed schemes. To actually thinking about, well, how is that going to be paid for? Is it a question about information, that people have got to be clear that they're paying for those technical skills? Because they're happy to pay a contractor, but who's going to be paid to manage that contractor? Is there perhaps a need for initial grant funding for that, seed corn monies? Alternatively, you've got to start looking at the grant funding that's provided under Home Energy Scotland. There's not an element of that that's allowed to pay for professional fees, which it is. So we've got to look how that structures it. But it starts taking it that every local authority should be expecting that, and how they're going to create that. And there probably will be different models, depending on the geography and the nature of it, where there's greater corporate responsibility. But I think we need to articulate what support is actually required, and recognising it's not just about advice. It's support through that whole customer journey that's required.
You've already spoken, all of you, a fair bit about LHEs, but I just had a couple of follow-up questions on that. I mean, you know, we've passed regulations now to require councils to produce their strategies, their delivery plans by the end of 2023. Do you think everything is in place to enable that to happen? Do you have concerns? And also just the scope of the LHEs as well, in terms of involvement of, you know, inclusion of public and commercial buildings in that mix as well. And I think earlier on you said about, you know, it should be every building, but does that include also historic buildings? Does it include public commercial buildings? And do you think, you know, we can get all the heat sources linked into these strategies as well, or are there going to be commercial heat sources where they say, no thanks, we're not interested in this, and we're going to resist connection to district heating or whatever? So just final just reflections on LHEs and where we might be going. Elaine, do you want to come in on that? Or?
The only other thing I would add that is just the kind of, as you asked about kind of barriers earlier, I think one of the key barriers, but also a kind of opportunity, is people, in that most people don't know that their next heating system isn't going to be the heating system the same as their existing heating system. So there needs to be a really big public engagement piece to kind of, and a public awareness raising piece to kind of push this forward and create that kind of ground, that demand from the bottom up. That was the only additional point I wanted to make.
Okay. Jeanette?
On, you know, are we ready to see those LHEs come to life, as it were, and turn into significant delivery plans? One of the missing areas, apart from all the technical kind of expertise and lining that up that we've talked about quite a lot, is the way that councils will use the multi-criteria assessment, so socioeconomic assessment, in order to develop their costing and prioritisation plans. I think it was Carbon Trust who were commissioned and came up with a pilot model, which they ran with a few local authorities who were broadly positive, but the feedback that we got in interviewing across the board with the trial LHEs local authorities was that they didn't quite know how to use this multi-criteria assessment. I mean, it put, roughly speaking, one-third weighting on carbon costs, whole life cycle carbon, one-third on fuel poverty, and then the remaining third was split between costs of finance, economics, local economy, and so on, the other stuff. And that was found to be requiring, not surprisingly, quite a lot of judgment, which people felt uncertain about, and how could they exercise that. So our sense, at least, was that there was a need for some, again, the Public Energy Agency kind of support and direction and training and guidance back and forth there, coordination, to make sure that we use that multi-criteria assessment to best effect, to get the results that we need.
To struggle because they don't have a specific local LHEs officer that like to do it. There should be a dedicated resource for that. There needs to be an understanding at a senior level how important that is for the future of the people living there and the local authority delivery as well. You mentioned, are you going to get all the commercial properties and the like there? You're not going to get all the ducks rolled up, and what we're better to do is have some certainty which affects the majority of people. If they're in some individual properties which are not going to be included, so be it. But if you can hit 80%, that would be great. So you should not be worried by not being perfect. We're living, the level of the climate emergency is such that we've got to be progressing that. And if you keep holding out to try and get everybody tied in, yes, if you get the major products, but there's got to be some flexibility to change with time as well, because I'm sure if you've got a good process coming forward, if you look at somewhere like Shetland, where everybody wants to be on the heat network now because it's seen as being the good thing there, people will come along, and there's got to be prepared to take some risks, and that is difficult politically, that taking risks, because there will be some things that go wrong. And that is difficult. I recognise that's difficult for you as politicians. But areas such as we should be putting in a network, a heat network, throughout, putting the pipes in like Leeds City Council is doing. They're putting in pipes down the road. There's a chance those pipes might not be needed for heat. But actually, whenever you dig up a road, you're putting in pipes. And the cost of that is actually relatively small if you're already carrying out the works, should that be a requirement of planning there. So you need to start making some decisions. Local authorities need to start decisions. They have to be said that. We've got to build that political consensus that decisions be made. Political consensus being built for the actual strategies, it's got to be built for the delivery as well, that this is not going to be straightforward. People are going to have to be prepared to pay for it, and our country's got to pay for it as well, which is a challenge.
Roger, anything to add to these?
No, I think that's significant.
Okay, thanks.
Thank you very much, Mark. Let me bring in Jackie Dunbar to be followed by Natalie Dawn. Jackie, over to you, please.
Thank you, convener, and thank you, panel, for your answers already this morning. You've covered a fair bit of what I was going to ask. So, but one thing we've not touched on yet is that that tenements and other older buildings leak heat, and that there's going to be huge technical challenges and legal barriers in insulating and decarbonising the heat for this type of property. What are going to be the barriers to maximise the fabric efficiency in the older properties? Roger, I'll come to you about the historical ones, but I'll come to maybe Theresa first in regards just to the older properties. You know, are we being restricted with trying to keep the aesthetic look of the buildings and moving forward? Should we be allowed to change that? I'd be interested in your views.
There are solutions which don't require the changing of it. That it is, though I've been very much arguing you've got to make decisions, that there are technical challenges in the way things are assessed, like the energy performance certificate probably doesn't reflect how a tenement, as a tenement owner, you know it's your windows, but actually that doesn't, because you can see all the heat leaking out. As Roger's often said, it's getting your shutters working. And if we had a uniform shutters process, sort of redesigning shutters so that they all worked, it would make a big difference to that. that there's also options of internal wall insulation. There are new technologies, certain fibres that can be that you can carry out internal wall insulation without losing your cornicing and the like. So I don't think you need lose your key aesthetics. Your windows may look a bit different, sort of, if you sort of have slight issues there about reflectivity. Does that really matter? And I think already Historic Environment Scotland has moved on that, but Roger Warpath, so your windows may look a bit different, but it is sort of your sandstone potential are not need not change that significantly. You may want to change what your stair looks like. It may, if you've got lovely tiling, that might be an issue, but lots of stairs could actually really be improved by having some insulation inside the stair. So I don't think we should get too hung up about it, and that things are changing with the reflections of what's required. But the process has got to be made easily. Can you have deemed consent taking place rather than having to go through listed building consent and go to planning and the like? I think that sort of the administrative things could be made simpler.
Roger, I saw you have a look there. Just to, so I'd be interested in your views. Just to, for quickness of time as well, do you think that there should be any changes made so regarding the options for tenements and listed buildings and conservation areas so that it's all the same rather than just in local areas?
Thank you. And to support Theresa's comments, tenements actually, as a typology, are quite efficient. The principal elevation is mostly glazed, as Theresa mentioned, and most of that glazing has been through two or three changes already. So in many cases, sometimes the kind of glazing that Theresa and I are after is actually probably better than what's there already. So it's almost a conservation gain. Lots of opportunities for external wall insulation on gable ends or rear elevations. And let's remember, a lot of this work should be folded into your maintenance cycle, but that's not really been happening either. So there's a sort of double deficit in terms of the technical options for tenements. Lots there actually. So we're comfortable on technically appropriate solutions. Again, the work with Glasgow City Council, Eglinton Street specifically, we're about to go into a pilot project with that. So I don't think it's aesthetics or energy efficiency. I don't think that's necessary. I think it's a fusion of both. And in many cases, let's remember, quite a lot of properties have been refurbished quite aggressively already. So your internal restrictions are very modest often. So I think there's a great opportunity to fuse local development, economic regeneration, local materials, supply chain, with an aesthetic regeneration. And get something that's really going forward. And the Hess Green Recovery Statement perhaps tries to capture that a bit better than I can put. I don't think changes are needed to the planning arrangements, because in fact, by my book, and there's links to our retrofit guide that I put around, you can do a hell of a lot within the LBC environment. And again, the numbers of buildings, listed buildings, are modest in comparison with the total. And a lot of what's happening, there's a lot of improved glazing at Edinburgh, a lot of very good glazing in Glasgow and everywhere else. So I wouldn't see that as a barrier. It's just understanding it and doing it properly.
I mean, in regards to me, not my constituency in Aberdeen, but in another one, I know that there has been a listed building in Aberdeen that they cannot get anything else bar the single glazing, because you probably know which one I mean. So that was kind of what I was meaning about how do we manage those two.
I think there's always the odd exception, and again, yeah. I don't know the case, but there is a comment being made about inconsistency of the application across Scotland, particularly by local authority planning areas, and I understand that. I get that quite a lot from manufacturers and contractors sometimes. So there is a piece to harmonise the application of this, but to emphasise, we've got glazing solutions pretty much up to the wire. There may be the odd occasion where there's a particular window, but actually we can do that with other measures, with secondary glazing or other things. So I think most things can be captured. I hope that helps.
Okay, thank you, Convener. I am.
That's great, Jackie. Thank you very much. Final questions from Natalie Dawn, who's joining us online. Natalie, over to you, please.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning to the panel. Yeah, so my question is just following from your previous responses, and my colleague Fiona earlier on touched on the written evidence from Historic Scotland, which raises concerns around how MPF4's new focus on sustainable development and the climate and nature emergencies relate to subsequent policies and whether any relative weighting applies. So I'm wondering how you feel whether should the climate and nature emergencies take precedence over other planning policies. And I believe Roger Curtis, you had stated earlier there had been some success with listed buildings. And going forward, I'm wondering how you feel we could best strike a balance between preserving historic urban environments and future-proofing them for climate change. If I could naturally go to Roger Curtis for that, please.
I think we've seen over the long term that established urban settlements are by their nature very durable because they were built with adversity in mind, particularly with respect to flooding. I think we are seeing issues from climate change, mainly in terms of water and water in the wrong place. And I think we're reaping a bit of a bitter harvest on the absence of maintenance. But I don't think it's an either or. And I think the innate sustainability of existing communities, both social and physical, should be a cause for celebration and investment, as opposed to a perceived millstone for compliance with reduced carbon targets. And I don't think, as I said, I think there is a proportionate balance to be struck, and we're using embodied carbon considerations and avoided outcomes that the traditional environment, and let's remember we're trying to speak for the traditionally built environment, not just the much smaller kind of historic quotient, absolutely has its part to play in durable materials, in natural sustainable materials, in low toxicity, in good indoor air quality. So I suppose we're just trying to be a bit cautious about carbon absolutism and operational energy alone is important, but there are many other factors that we're seeking to bring into the discussion to have a more nuanced, possibly, dare I say it, longer-term approach to the traditional and historic environment, which, as we know, in the urban centres of Scotland is a defining characteristic on which a lot of economic well-being depends, and how we look at that and present that to the world and our citizens.
Thank you. Thanks very much, Roger. In the interest of time, my further questions have been answered previously in the session, so unless any other members of the panel would like to come in, I'm happy to pass back to the convener.
Thank you very much. Natalie, I believe that Liam Kerr has a very brief supplemental in this area. Liam, please.
It really will be very brief. Just on the answers that two of you gave to Jackie Dunbar, in relation to tenements, so yes, it might be the best thing to do to replace a window, but that is not cheap, even for one. So the question again seems to me, who pays for this? Because people living who have bought, let's say, a two-bedroom flat are not necessarily fuel poor, but they're equally not going to be able to spend £20,000 to put a new window in or to put stuff in the walls to insulate it. So who pays for it?
£20,000 was an overall average figure. I think a tenement, as I indicated, is a very economically effective way of dwelling, and the figures will come through as our pilot progresses. But upgrade and improvement of a central property within a tenement would be, I'd suggest, less than that. We're coming into the financial model of borrowing and access to capital and lending, which is not really my area. But again, I think let's not make the perfect the enemy of the good in terms of retrofit. And in our view, and we've articulated it in our refurbishment approach, is don't let the perfect be the enemy of the good. Get ourselves to an EPC band C, reducing the operational use for those residents, and maybe repair and upgrade as a better carbon solution and a more affordable solution than wholesale replacement.
There will be a need for combination, that not everybody's going to be able to pay at once. You can take often a smaller scale approach, that if you were to say replace the windows for your sitting room but not bother with the bedrooms, that will actually give you quite a saving because that's the room you normally live in. There is a role for grant funding for some groups, but it's at the long term that there are going to be the need for models of finance that people are able to afford to pay, so that you can spread it, that if you're going to be getting your savings over a 20-year period, because with energy efficiency measures, they are cost-efficient investments. It is not the overall, it's a net benefit investing in those. So how do you fit your financial models in to allow that replacement? And it may well be that over time, there will be it won't be till the house is sold that the people move on from their two-bed flat, and it's the next, yes, they have a slightly lower value that they will get for their home. So it will take time. Just a slight thing there, we're building new homes that are going to be retrofitted. And that is appalling, that the new homes we're building are going to need to be retrofitted. So no new person moving into a new built home should have to be retrofitting their homes, because that should be built into the price there. But it is a difficult conversation. Not everybody's going to be able to afford it at the moment. There'll be the most fuel poor that, yes, the public purse should be supporting. There will be those who can afford to do it, but it is a difficulty. There'll be people in the middle who are not, don't see themselves as able to self-fund, but would not fall into the fuel poor category. And is that going to be that those homes are going to take longer to retrofit? Will probably be one option. But because it's a positive return on carbon investment, that's where private finance comes in. If you want a positive, the cheapest way of buying carbon is by doing energy efficiency. People are after carbon. And if you can do it by energy efficiency and monetarise that, people will want to invest in it, because it's much cheaper to do energy efficiency in terms of carbon than planting woods and offsetting. How do you get that business model created? Which, yes, you need some economists to be able to work that out for you. But people are crying out for that. You see the price of land going up in Scotland because people want to plant forests. How do you make offsetting work for energy efficiency measures?
Convener.
OK, thank you very much, Liam. That brings us to the end of our allocated time. Let me thank our panel members very much for your comprehensive answers and your insights. It's been very useful for the committee to hear from each of you this morning. Thank you for taking part, and enjoy the rest of your day. I will now briefly suspend the meeting for the setup of our next agenda item. Thank you. Good morning. Welcome back. Our next item today is our last evidence session in relation to our inquiry into energy price increases. This inquiry is looking at the steep rise in energy prices, what is driving this, what impact it is having, and what can be done to alleviate this. Today, we will hear from Michael Matheson, MSP, Cabinet Secretary for Net Zero Energy and Transport. Good morning. Welcome, Cabinet Secretary. We also welcome Neil Ritchie, Head of Energy Services and Consumer Policy of the Scottish Government. And I also welcome Eleanor Whittam, MSP, who joins us for this evidence session. Good morning. We have around 70 minutes for this session. Cabinet Secretary, I believe that you would like to begin by making a brief opening statement, so I will hand over to you.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning to the committee. Households across the country are currently struggling to cope with the cumulative pressures of the cost of living crisis, and energy costs lie at the heart of this. Record high inflation, in large part driven by energy price increases, has forced thousands of people to choose between heating or eating and to experience the worst living standards decline in the last few decades. The tragic events in Ukraine have exacerbated the already elevated fuel prices to unprecedented levels, and the impacts are felt by both domestic and business consumers in Scotland. We've also seen that standing charges in bills doubled, meaning that even reducing consumption does not save as much. Scotland, as a forerunner in renewable energy generation, and has the potential to help to expand our renewable capacity in reducing energy bills. However, investment is being held back due to unfair network charges, which I believe is a missed opportunity during the present energy crisis. A significant number of Scottish households are off the mains gas grid, and due to the interconnected nature of the energy markets, natural gas prices increases have had a knock-on effect on electricity, heating oil and LPG prices. The Scottish Government is set to invest almost £770 million this year in helping to tackle the cost of living pressures, including a £150 cost of living award to support households with higher energy costs, and a further investment of £10 million to continue our fuel insecurity fund. Crucially, we are also committed to investing at least £1.8 billion over the next 5 years on heating and insulating Scotland's homes and buildings. We have repeatedly called for urgent and targeted support from the UK government, both in the immediate and longer term, like a one-off windfall tax on companies benefiting from significantly higher profits through the pandemic and energy crisis, direct financial support for low-income households, improvements to the Warm Homes Discount Scheme, and a temporary removal of VAT on energy bills. Sadly, in the March budget, in the energy security strategy, and last week in the Queen's speech, the UK government repeatedly failed to deliver anything to match the scale and the urgency of what is required. However, we continue to engage with the UK government on these matters, and we're also engaging with stakeholders and the sector to explore what more we can do and how we can work on a four nations basis in order to try to help to address what is a growing crisis for many households. And of course, Convener, I'm happy to respond to any questions the committee may have.
Thank you very much, Cabinet Secretary, for your opening remarks. And yes, we will move to questions. My first question relates to evidence the committee received from Citizens Advice Scotland when they appeared before the committee a couple of weeks ago. They expressed concern about the coordination of information to tackle fuel poverty. Their concern was that the people most in need are not getting the information they need when and where they need that information, and they expressed a general concern about the confused level of information available to people most in need. I wonder if you could address those concerns, and what more can the Scottish Government do to make sure that information is available for those most in need, and that they're getting relevant and immediate access to that information.
So the principal source of advice for energy efficiency and energy issues in Scotland that's supported by the Scottish Government is through Home Energy Scotland, which will provide advice and guidance. It also provides loans for certain programmes around energy efficiency and renewable energy schemes for your property. They're the principal source of advice and information for assistance in Scotland. Alongside that, we also have the Warmer Homes Scotland programme that's taken forward in partnership with our colleagues in local government. I do think at the present moment there is an increasing demand for information on energy efficiency programmes and advice around heating bills. That's why we've increased the scope of the Homes Energy Scotland programme by 20%. And there's a specific bespoke programme which is for those who are the most vulnerable, which has been doubled in order to help to support the provision of advice and information. So I think there is an existing clear arrangement for where you can get that impartial advice and information from. But of course, I'm always, you know, willing to look at whether there are ways that can be improved or whether we have to look at expanding that further. And if there are specific examples where people are left confused or unclear as to where they should go to, how we can make sure that we're communicating that much more effectively, because there is a bespoke service there that people can turn to for advice and information.
Thank you very much, Cabinet Secretary. My second question relates to the resources available for third sector organisations to provide the support and advice you just mentioned. When Citizens Advice Scotland appeared before the committee, they expressed a concern about a mismatch between resources available to them and other third sector organisations and the need for their services. As you said, there has been an exponential increase in the demand for services in recent months, but the third sector organisations are working with budgets, staffing and resources that are static or sometimes which are being cut. Do you recognise those concerns expressed by the third sector, and what more can the Scottish Government do to support those organisations?
So I do recognise that they're under greater pressure because of the cost of living crisis. So there are specific measures which we have taken. So as I mentioned, we've expanded the Home Energy Scotland programme by 20% and doubled the bit that's specifically for those who are most vulnerable. We've put another £10 million into the Fuel Insecurity Fund, which again is administered by third sector organisations on our behalf to provide them with the financial resource. There have been some challenges that some third sector organisations have faced because of concerns about funding going forward and future funding. I suspect most of that is linked into the Warms Home Discount programme and the delay in the decisions made by the UK government in taking that programme forward, which has created points of vulnerability for some third sector organisations on whether they would have funding going forward into the new financial year. I believe the UK government have now sought to address that in the regulations that they set out in February of this year to roll forward the programme again. So I think we are, trying to provide resource where we can to third sector organisations to help to support them in this area of work. I'm very conscious that it's not all in energy, so there will be other third sector organisations that are dealing with other aspects of the cost of living crisis that will provide advice and information. But we're also looking actively where there's further work that we can do with third sector organisations to support them, just given increasing demand which they are facing over and above the additional support we've already provided. But I fully recognise and acknowledge that they are under considerable pressure and demand given the cost of living crisis that many households are facing.
Thank you very much for that response. Let me bring in other members of the committee, and first of all, Fiona Hislop, please.
Good morning, Cabinet Secretary. With the Governor of the Bank of England stating apocalyptic food price increases with global food supply shortages will increase inflation further, the current cost of living crisis will get worse and energy prices are expected to increase again come October. Do you acknowledge the view of some energy and poverty advice bodies who say that neither the UK or the Scottish governments are treating this as a real crisis?
I don't accept that on the part of the Scottish Government, because we recognise it's a crisis and there's a considerable amount of cross-departmental work already taking place across government, the Scottish Government, to try and help to address some of these issues going forward. So internally in government, our processes and mechanisms for dealing with it are reflective of it being a crisis. I do accept that I think the level of intervention that's taken place so far has not reflected that of a crisis. So I think there is absolutely no doubt in my mind that a key priority, it must be about trying to either reduce household bills or to get money into people's pockets in order to do that. So I think when you have things like benefit cuts, like the £20 universal credit uplift being removed, and when you have things like national insurance increasing, it feels as though it's not been recognised as a crisis, I certainly think, by the UK government. And I certainly think their failure to take action in the publication of their UK energy security strategy, in the budget in March, and also in the Queen's speech last week, do not reflect what I would believe is the necessary action we require at a UK level in order to tackle the spiralling crisis that households are facing as a result of the increase in energy costs. So we are doing what we can with our fixed resources to try and marshal those in a way that provide what assistance where we can. And we're looking to see where there's more we could do going forward internally in government. But I certainly think there is a need for a much more concerted crisis-type approach by the UK government in intervening either in the market or in providing support financially that will help to address the increasing costs that households are facing.
So measures from both governments today are obviously welcome, but as we heard from Greg Hands, the UK Minister, last week, they are adopting a wait-and-see approach. They've not brought forward an emergency budget, and they clearly see the energy price increase challenges as a welfare issue. What is your view? Do you see it as a welfare issue or energy issue or both? And particularly from the energy responsibilities that you have and your insight, what measures in terms of energy do you think can be delivered? And what is your view on the proposal from Scottish Power and Keith Anderson for a social tariff of that £1,000 proposal that there's a cut in bills?
So look, there's a lot in there. So let me unpick some of that. So I disagree with the wait and see approach. You know, the increase in energy costs for direct debit saw a £693 increase in their default tariff, and those in prepayment customers saw a £708 increase in their default tariff. So I don't know what you have to wait to see what you're going to do, given that people are already experiencing very significant financial challenge now. And that's why I don't agree with the wait-and-see approach. The measures which have been taken, I don't think, go far enough, but I think we need to go much further. So do you deal with it as a welfare issue or do you deal with it as an energy issue? I think it's a combination of both. It's not one or the other. We need to make sure that we are taking action through the welfare provisions that are available. So, for example, as I mentioned, you know, reinstating the £20 cut in universal credit would be a step in the right direction to try and help to address the crisis. It was introduced because of the pandemic, a crisis, but it's been removed at the very peak, or almost potentially at the very peak of a cost of living crisis. So I think that's the wrong thing to do. We've sought to use the welfare powers that we have to try and help to manage that. So by doubling the child payment and increasing it by a further £5, also by increasing the 8 benefits that we are responsible for by 6%, given the cost of living crisis that households are facing, to try and uplift them much more in line with that. So we are seeking to try and manage to use the welfare powers that we do have to try and help to meet some of these costs as well. But I recognise that that's not sufficient in itself. And I think in the energy markets, we do need to see action being taken. Some of that will be short term, some of it will be medium term. So I think in the short term, I think the proposal that Keith Anderson set out with the deficit fund as a potential mechanism is one option that should be looked at and considered. I think there are a range of other things that we could do as well. For example, removing VAT from them, looking at some of the social environmental costs which are attached to energy bills as well, potentially, which could save households in the region of about £140 to £150 on their bill, measures that potentially could be removed. So I think there are areas within energy that could also be addressed in the short term. And I think in the medium term, we need to keep in mind is that energy bills are also going up because of failures in the market, because so many companies have actually withdrawn, retail companies have withdrawn from the energy markets, which has resulted in costs having to be added on to household bills in order to meet those company failures. That says to me there has been clear systemic regulatory failure within the sector. You know, these companies broadly fall into two categories, those that are hedged and those that are unhedged. Those that have largely left the retail market are unhedged companies. They didn't have the business plan or the business structure to be able to absorb big spikes in energy costs. They've withdrawn from the market, and because of the supplier of last resort arrangements, the costs of that have actually been transferred onto other companies, which are then socialised across the rest of our energy costs. So that in itself would say there's a systemic failure in the sector, and that needs to be addressed. And I'm not convinced that Ofgem have set out actions that will address that in the future as yet. I think there's more that they need to do in that area, and I'm more than happy to expand and to explore that as well. And the final point I'd make as well is that we need to, given that many of these costs are directly attributable to the big spike in energy costs which are driven by wholesale gas prices, we need to speed up decarbonisation. And I welcome the fact that the UK government have also acknowledged that the priority now needs to be moving towards renewables at a faster pace in order to do so in a way that gives us energy security, but also given that renewables are lowering cost, it will help to drive down bills in the longer term as well. So I think it's not one thing or the other, it's a combination. And where we can take action, we're trying to take action, but there's no doubt in my mind there is much more needs to be done in this area.
On Ofgem, you've said that you think that the market regulation has failed. So what changes do you want to see to see improvements? Also, on the short term, we've heard that Ofgem are saying that if anyone's in trouble, they should just go to their suppliers. Do you think there needs to be some kind of requirement and provision of independent advice rather than reference to suppliers? And in relation to the unfair, you know, obviously market in terms of transmission charges, you've been outspoken about that as well. We've also heard that can have consequences potentially. So again, I'd be interested in your views there. So what changes do you think Ofgem need to make? And perhaps you might share your view as to whether you agree with the consumer expert Martin Lewis that the move to potentially energy price cap change four times a year suits energy companies rather than consumers. So views on Ofgem, please.
So first of all, on Ofgem, so I think first of all, the fact that we've had such a large number of companies exit the market during the present crisis, largely unhedged companies, demonstrates what I think has been a gamble that's been taken in the energy market by companies. They've been gambling on with a business model that is based upon low wholesale gas prices, and it's gone wrong for them. And they simply move out of the market, and the cost of that is then picked up by consumers. Because of the way in which the supplier of last resort system operates. I don't think we should tolerate companies operating in the energy markets that don't have the capital and capacity to manage what could be volatility within energy markets. They've been gambling when it's been low on it, when it's worked for them, and then when it's went up, they've decided to get out of the market because the business model no longer works. And I think the regulator should have addressed that at an earlier stage, because there was always a potential for this to happen. You know, it's okay to say with hindsight, you know, we should have moved at an earlier stage, but the regulator is there to look at modelling potential risks, to protect the customer. And in this case, I think they've failed. And I think the system has failed for consumers. And we will pick up the costs of this for many years to come.
given the billions of pounds that are involved in having to be made as a result of that. So I think there is a need for the regulator to recognise their failure on this part. And I think the UK government should also be looking at why that has been allowed to happen and how we can make sure that doesn't happen again in the future with any regulatory changes which are introduced by Ofgem going forward. Which brings me on to the announcement that they intend to move to a quarterly price cap mechanism system rather than being on twice a year. I don't really think it changes anything. It's not going to change people's household bills unless the cost of fuel starts to significantly drop. All it will mean is that you might get a drop in your price at an earlier stage. Rather than waiting 6 months, you might only have to wait 3 months to actually get that drop off in price, which is a positive. But I don't think it's going to change anything in the present market, given where we expect energy prices to go over the course of the next year to 18 months, from what I'm getting from the intelligence I'm getting from the of the sector. But I also think it risks putting people in difficulty as well. So if you were to take the price cap increase in October last year, which saw a significant rise in itself, at the time when people are making peak demand in their energy consumption during the winter, they at least know they've got some respite until April before the next price cap review is implemented. What would have happened if you had a quarterly system is that you'd have had an increase in January, right at the peak when folks' energy use is probably at its highest level. And you could have saw more people being put into financial difficulty as a result. So I think there are some potential unintended consequences of moving to this idea of four price caps a year. There are potential benefits, as I mentioned, but there are also potential downsides. But I don't think it highlights the type of fundamental reform that's necessary to make sure that we have an energy market that is protecting the consumer's interest. And the very fact that we had so many companies exit the market for the reasons that I outlined demonstrates that the consumer's interest, I don't think, was sufficiently front and centre in the way in which the system was being regulated. And in terms of issues around, I know Ofgem's view is that you should go to your energy company first if you have issues of concern. I think, in by and large, I do think that is probably still advice which is good advice, because some energy companies have they have hardship funds, they have payment plans that they can assist people with if they are having difficulty. It's important that the regulator is scrutinising the way in which suppliers are providing that advice and information, and that it is that it is appropriate information that are being provided with, and also providing them with advice where they can go to for independent advice over and above what they're being told by their energy supplier. And on the issue of transmission charges, well, it continues to act as a barrier for the rollout of renewables in Scotland. We know that it makes renewable, both onshore and offshore, more expensive than other parts of the UK, because we still have a geographical-based system. We know that, completely unbeknown to the Scottish Government, that Ofgem brought forward this proposal with no consultation with the Scottish Government on locational marginal pricing. Came completely out of the blue, despite the fact that apparently they'd been working on it for over a year. And we meet with them on I meet with Ofgem almost on a quarterly basis. No intelligence about this whatsoever. And our early analysis of it is that potentially it would have a negative impact on Scottish projects still, even more so potentially. So we're doing further work with that. We've discussed the matter with the National Grid to express our frustration and unhappiness at the lack of engagement with the Scottish Government on such an important issue. It's obviously now feeding into a consultation exercise which BEIS are taking forward as part of their transmission charging arrangements. So it's one option. It's not necessarily that option. It'll be interesting to see what other options BEIS choose to bring forward. But the reality is that we have a, a, a transmission charging mechanism that is designed on the basis of transmission charges being applied on the basis of being closer to the population centres. The reality is that the vast majority of renewable energy in the future will come from locations away from population centres. Therefore, we need to have a transmission charging scheme that recognises that, is fair to consumers, is fair to developers, and doesn't become a barrier to the type of investment that is absolutely critical to making sure we drive down energy costs, and that is by ramping up renewable energy capacity.
Thank you. Convener.
Thank you very much, Fiona. I believe that Liam Kerr has a supplemental in this area. Liam, over to you, please.
Yes, thank you, Convener. Cabinet Secretary, you said earlier, or you called for targeted support from the UK government, although, of course, a VAT cut or a windfall tax that you mentioned wouldn't be targeted. This committee's heard that fuel poverty and domestic policy in this area is devolved, and your solution is to get money into people's pockets. Now, in 2021, you had a fiscal transfer of £12 billion, which is about £2,210 per person extra in Scotland. So since you disagree with a wait-and-see approach, what is your government doing with that extra money to get money into people's pockets?
You're right to point out that tackling fuel poverty is a devolved matter, but many of the factors that influence it are reserved. Let me finish my point first, Mr. Kerr. But that's the facts of the matter. So, for example, fuel poverty is greater in Scotland because the household cost of using fuel in Scotland is greater than it is in other parts of the UK because of our weather and our rural environment. The amount that a household in Scotland uses on its fuel costs is greater in Scotland. It's about 4.8% compared to about 3.9% in England. So we spend more of our budgets on heating our homes in Scotland. We also have a greater proportion of our households that are off-grid and off-mains systems, which are more costly to operate as a result as well. I think it's about 17% compared to about 12% in England. It's rough figures, not specific figures in itself. So these are factors that influence the cost of energy, and they have an impact on energy bills as well. So what's the Scottish Government doing it? So we have our Warmer Homes Scotland programme, which is an energy efficiency programme, insulating properties. As I mentioned in the course of this Parliament, there will be record investment getting into our building heating homes programme, which is at £1.8 billion, which is a record level of investment. We've been expanding the way in which we use our area-based scheme and the households and how much they can get to help to support them with energy efficiency as well. We've also expanded and we're tending to increase the level of investment put into things like the benefits that we do control. So another practical example is that if I was to take something like the winter fuel payment scheme, which we'll become responsible for, we are introducing that in a way which means that it will be an automatic payment that families or households will receive rather than actually having to wait to see whether the weather gets cold enough. I think, for example, that will be about £20 million a year that we've been putting into households, which will support additional households that will benefit from that, is in the region of 400,000 homes. If you compare that to the winter there, I think the co-payment system that UK government operate was only triggered on something like six occasions, of which four of the weather stations in Scotland were triggered. The overall amount of payout from the DWP in supporting low-income households at that particular time was a region of under £400,000, compared to what will be an automatic £20 million that will be invested by the Scottish Government through the cold weather payments scheme as well. So between energy efficiency programmes, the benefits that we control, we are seeking to make a difference. However, there are aspects of the market which are controlled by the UK government that have a direct impact on energy costs, and that is the regulation of off-grid provision and also the way in which they operate the warm homes discount scheme as well, all of which have an impact on fuel poverty here in Scotland, which we believe they need to address in order to make sure that we are moving in the right direction. And the final point I would make here as well is that while we are taking action in the benefits and the welfare provisions that we have to try and help to reduce poverty, whether it be fuel poverty or child poverty, it has not been aided by cutting people's benefits at the same time. So it means that anything that we do, so we increase our benefits by £20 in a household, and they then find that the UK government benefits are being cut by £20, we find that we've got no net gain for that investment in trying to reduce poverty, whether it be child poverty or whether it be fuel poverty. So the reality is, many of the levers that have a direct impact on driving fuel poverty in Scotland are held by the UK government, and it has a negative impact in too many households across the country. And that's why we need to see action from the UK government alongside the type of bold action that the Scottish Government is taking in order to try and address some of these issues that have affected too many households for too long.
I'll come back on those points later. Thanks, Convener.
OK, great, Liam. Cabinet Secretary, we have a number of members, obviously, who have questions in this important area. Fully understand that you want to provide comprehensive answers, but given the timetable we're up against, if your answers could be slightly more concise, that would be very welcome. Let me bring in Monica Lennon, who's joining us online. Monica, over to you, please.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, Cabinet Secretary. As well as supporting a windfall tax on oil and gas producer profit, do you agree, Cabinet Secretary, that the UK Government needs to introduce an emergency budget? And is the Scottish Government considering an emergency budget of its own to ensure that the cost of living crisis and energy costs are being treated with the right level of priority here in Scotland?
Good morning. I don't believe we should just have a windfall tax on energy companies. Our view is that there should be a windfall tax on those companies that have made significant profits during the course of the pandemic, and also the oil and gas sector, which are the energy sector, which would actually expand the range of any windfall tax and increase the pot potentially, which would be available to the UK government to take forward measures that could help to address the cost of living crisis. I do sense a slight shift in the Chancellor's position on this over the course of the weekend, which would suggest that he is possibly starting to think about the possibility of introducing a windfall tax. On potentially the energy sector. We're not presently looking at bringing forward an emergency budget because we have a fixed budget, so it's not about being able to draw in extra resource. What we are doing, though, is in government, is we're looking at the present allocation of funding we have across different portfolios to see if there are ways in which we can look at targeting more of that towards those who are experiencing particular difficulty during the cost of living crisis. So that's a piece of work that's been taken forward just now at the present moment. But given that we have a fixed budget, there are no plans at the present time to have an emergency budget.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. That's a helpful response. We heard a few weeks ago some evidence from some of the fuel energy charities, and there was some discussion about your government's fuel insecurity fund. And I believe it's in its third round, and it's been roughly £10 million in each fund. So there was some concern, particularly from Citizens Advice Scotland, that that money might not last a full 3 months this time. So have you had any advice on how long that money will last, and have you got any plans to increase that pot?
So we're presently, I think, due to receive data from the third sector organisations that are distributing that fund for us to look at where we're at in terms of its distribution, and whether there is a need for us to look at adding additional resources to that. So that's part of what we're looking at in the wider response from government around measures that we could take to try to help to support people. It's a fund that's specific to those who are experiencing particular distress in meaning their energy costs, and also those that are at risk of self-disconnecting as well. It is quite specific and targeted as a fund, but we are expecting to get data, I think, from the third sector organisations in the coming weeks around how the fund has been utilised at the present moment in terms of overall amount of the fund, and we'll then be able to assess whether we need to do more to try to help to support and sustain that fund going forward. So I'd say we're very open to looking to see where there's further support we can provide through that fund if it is necessary.
Thank you. It'd be helpful if you could keep the committee updated, because we did hear concerns about an increase in people self-disconnecting, and that is a real concern. Earlier on, Cabinet Secretary, you talked about, you know, the need for the UK government to do more, and also for Scottish Government to be doing more as part of a four-nation approach. You did say you're in regular discussion with Ofgem, the energy regulator. When did you last have a discussion with the UK Minister Greg Hands, who we heard from last week? How often are ministers in Scotland having dialogue with the UK government about these really important matters affecting everyone in the country?
Myself and my colleague Shona Robison wrote to the UK government in January, and I think in that letter we proposed a four nations approach to tackling the increasing cost of living crisis. And then I, along with Kate Forbes, wrote again in March, again looking for a four nations approach in these matters. And to date, the UK government haven't taken up that offer.
Does that mean you haven't had a response, or have they declined the offer?
I think the response I got was from Kwasi Kwarteng, which was largely saying these matters could be discussed at the Four Nations Net Zero Joint Ministerial Group, if I recall correctly. Maybe wrong specifically on that, but I think that was what it is. But we asked them to work with us in creating a joint ministerial group back in January of this year, which they haven't taken up the offer of. So they haven't engaged with us specifically on tackling the cost of living crisis.
Well, that is worrying. We did hear from some of the charity experts who have advisers on the front line speaking to people across Scotland that unless both the UK government and the Scottish government do more, there will be a catastrophic loss of life this winter. Do you recognise those concerns, and are you willing to do more to work with the UK government and others to try and save lives this year?
Well, when you say they recognise it, well, we recognised it back in January. That's why we suggested that there should be a four nations approach to tackling the issue, and that there should be a four nations joint ministerial group, largely in a similar way in which we worked on a four nations basis on issues around the pandemic. But that offer hasn't been taken up by the UK government. Will we work with them? Of course we will. We'll work with them, where we can, and we'll highlight the actions that we think should be taken. But, you know, you can only work with parties if they're prepared to work with you as well. But we haven't had a positive response to working on a four nations basis yet, on a joint ministerial basis with all four nations, which I think would be the right thing to do, given the nature of the crisis.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. Again, I think it would be helpful for this committee to see any relevant correspondence, because we'll want to make our own recommendations. Just kind of a last question from me. Well, two quick last questions. Talk about bold action, publicly owned energy company. Is this something that you're keeping under review? I know it was a commitment from the SNP party previously, and I think also from the Greens. Is this something that's been looked at as part of the Bute House agreement?
So as I've said previously, I think at the committee is that our priority is to move towards a public sector, a public energy agency company in Scotland, which is the piece of work that we're taking forward at the present moment. That hasn't changed. It remains. Our view is that in my view, in order to operate an effective public energy agency company, you not only require to be able to enter the retail market, you also need to be in the energy generation market as well, and you also have to be able to control aspects of the grid network. And as it stands, we don't have that power. My view is that the best way in which to deliver a public energy agency company in Scotland that can do all of these things is through Scotland being a non-independent country, taking responsibility for these matters, being able to borrow the capital that's needed to invest in these types of projects, just in the exact same way that many other countries in the Scandinavian region of Europe have been able to do over recent years, some of which are now investing in Scottish renewable energy projects because they've been able to actually secure the capital that's necessary to invest in these types of projects. So I think it still has merit, but I think to do it effectively and to do it properly, it would require all of the powers
around energy to be able to do so, and also to have the borrowing powers that's necessary to be able to deliver the type of investment that's necessary to create renewable energy projects. But beyond that, our priority just now is the agencies I've previously set out.
Okay, no doubt we'll come back to the role of the agency and what more could be done in public ownership. The last question then, because I think it's a very topical issue, I think a decision is expected soon. Should the UK government regulator give consent to the proposed Jackdaw oil fields? I know the Scottish Government is opposed to Cambo. Are you also opposed to Jackdaw being consented?
So Jackdaw is a different stage, and I saw your motion that you'd lodged in Parliament in the matter. Our position is in Jackdaw is the same as it is with Cambo. Our position has actually been reinforced by both the Scottish and UK government's independent advisor on climate change, the Committee on Climate Change, who have said that there should be a compatibility checkpoint, not just for those consented developments that are not in production as yet, but also for new projects, but also for those that are consented that are not in production. Our view on Jackdaw is exact same as it is with Cambo in terms of the compatibility checkpoints, which has now been reinforced by the view and recommendation of the Committee on Climate Change.
Okay, thank you. Back to you, Convener.
Thank you very much, Monica. Let me bring in Mark Ruskell to be followed by Liam Kerr. Mark, over to you, please.
Thanks, Convener. There's a few areas which I think have already been covered, actually, but if I can move on to some others. So the windfall tax, I mean, it does look like it's going to be a situation, a matter of, when rather than if this gets brought in. What would be your priorities for spending that windfall tax? Would it be something like a deficit fund? Would it be frontline energy efficiency advice? How do you think any kind of reinvestment in this area should be deployed in a way to benefit those people who are really struggling right now?
Combination of factors. So I think the first thing is about trying to find mechanisms that can get money into the pockets or to reduce energy bills for those that are most vulnerable. So I would our priorities would be to have a targeted programme which either, whether it be through the welfare mechanisms or through some other mechanism, to try and help to support most vulnerable households with their energy costs would be my first priority. Second would be in relation to energy efficiency. The cheapest form of energy you can use is the energy you don't use, if you like. So that's a bit contradictory, but the cheapest energy is the energy you don't use, if you like. So we need to try and help to ramp up energy efficiency programmes. We are seeking to do that with the £1.8 billion I said over this Parliament, which is a record level of investment. But of course, we could always look to try and do more than that. So in money investment into energy efficiency. And the third area I would say is a priority is advice and information for householders and what they can do and what their options are as well to support individuals that are looking for information and advice. So they're the three areas that I would prioritise in any investment that's going to be available in the next couple of months to try and help households through this particular challenging period.
The 20% uplift in funding for Home Energy Scotland, is that model of individual advice, telephone advice, detailed renewables reports, ongoing engagement, is that really cutting it? Is that getting through to the maximum number of people, or do we need to think differently about how that advice is delivered? Could it be through other agencies? Could it be through the NHS? Could it be through other areas that are engaging with people who are struggling with the cost of living crisis at the moment?
So I think potentially yes. So looking at other ways in which I think are often referred to as touch points when people are engaging with a range of different public agencies, is there a way in which we could make information available to the, to members of the public around what they can do to meet some of the cost of life challenges which they are experiencing? So I think that could have a part to play. I think the Home Energy Scotland programme, it was never designed to deal with the crisis of this scale. But I think it's a very valuable part of the advice landscape that we've got in Scotland to give independent, impartial advice on
energy efficiency measures and also provide some financial support for those that want to take forward some of those energy efficiency measures as well. So I think it's got an important part to play, but it's not the only answer. It shouldn't be. We shouldn't view it as being the only approach. But I think we can look at a broader programme. Part of that might be about just providing people with advice and information about some measures that you can take. You know, I know the International Energy Agency have set out a range of actions that they say that households and governments can take in order to try to help to reduce energy consumption. You can distill some of that to a localised level as well, and how households can take measures forward that can reduce their energy consumption. So there are other ways in which you can try to get that advice and information across. And that's something we're presently looking at in government just now as part of any programme of work going forward.
Last week we had, as you're aware, Greg Hands in committee, and he gave quite wide-ranging evidence on all sorts of things, including on nuclear energy, where he described the Scottish Government's opposition to nuclear as being ideological. How do you respond to that? Do you think there's a role in nuclear in terms of reducing energy bills? Or?
Well, nuclear is not going to reduce energy bills anytime soon. So nuclear projects take a long period of time to be developed. So you just have to look at Hinkley Point C. It's behind schedule and it's about £5 billion over budget. Given the subsidy costs it requires as well, it's likely to force up bills. I think our estimates were potentially about an extra £40 on folks' bills. So nuclear energy is one of the most expensive forms of energy you can produce. And I think even last week, Kwasi Kwarteng, the Energy Secretary of the UK Government, acknowledged there is a risk that nuclear will push up bills even in the short term as well. So I think it's the wrong approach. We can see other countries in Europe moving out of nuclear. So Germany, they will close their last reactor this year. Very clear their strategy is to focus very much on renewables as the approach you want to take. Our approach to nuclear isn't an ideological one. Greg Hands has said that to me before, and it's been pointed out to him it's wrong. We set out in our energy strategy back in 2017 the principles in which we do not support nuclear energy. We also think that the best approach in Scotland going forward is to focus on renewables. Pump storage, hydro and battery storage capacity are the ways in which to target our future energy needs. We know that both onshore and offshore wind are significantly cheaper and they produce significantly lower cost energy. We also know that hydro, by and large, produces much lower cost energy as well. We have a number of schemes in Scotland that could be taken forward, but you know, it's quite frustrating. We're in a position where, although there are projects in Scotland, I think Drax pointed out that they are planning Cruachan 2, which I think is, when I visited last year, it's a 600 megawatt facility. The problem is that they can't take it to the market because the UK government haven't provided the market mechanism for it to get into the grid. So, you know, it's an investment of over, I think, £1.5 billion. It would potentially see about 900 jobs. It would obviously have the ongoing benefit of being a renewable energy source as well, sort of idea, but they don't have a route to market. The same with SSE and some of their plans around hydro. I was at Sloy just a fortnight ago, where they're looking to expand it as well and develop it. And again, there is limitations there because of a lack of a market mechanism by the UK government, which is quite frustrating. And when you look at the countries that have got the lowest energy costs in the world, Norway and Canada, what's the big source that they use? Hydro and pump storage. I think it's over 90% in Norway, over 60% or around 60% in Canada. So our view is that the best approach for delivering energy security and lower cost energy supplies in the future in Scotland is through renewable energy projects, whether that be onshore, offshore, solar, hydro, pump storage and battery storage. They are the way in which we should be focusing on our energy needs in the future, and I think that's why the UK government have got it seriously wrong in their energy strategy or their security strategy in focusing way too much on nuclear, which potentially will actually see energy prices maintained at a higher level than they should be or potentially going up over and above what they've been.
And just final question really about domestic consumers, particularly in rural areas where
you know, the price of oil, the price of LPG is very volatile. It's been spiking recently, great concerns. Do you support a better regulation of the oil and LPG markets, potentially even a price cap on those supplies?
Again, it's very, because of the interconnected nature of the energy sector, the wholesale, gas prices are forcing up LPG and oil gas heating as well. Our view is that the need for regulation in this sector. We've raised this now on a number of occasions with the UK government. It's very clear they've got no plans to regulate the sector, or they don't intend to. I know that the sector are engaging with BEIS to look at what they can do to try to help to meet some of the spiralling costs that off-grid properties are now facing as well. But in my view, given that it's something like 17% in Scotland are off-grid, but 17% of our population are off-grid, it's an area that strikes me as it should have some level of regulation around it in order to try and help to manage some of the potential cost impact that big spikes can have on households. So I know it's not as big in England, it's about 12%, but it's still a sizeable amount, 12%. So I do think there's a need for some market intervention. What that should be is that there's obviously a variety of different models you could look at, but I think at the very least there should be some sort of engagement around looking at different options to try and regulate the sector, given the impact it has on so many fuel-poor households in rural parts of Scotland.
Back to you.
Thank you very much, Mark. Cabinet Secretary, just on your point about supporting more renewable projects that you mentioned to Mark Ruskell, I assume you recognise the importance of the UK government's contract for difference mechanism as a means for leveraging private investment, including offshore renewables?
Yeah, I do. CFD, and I think it was a positive thing that they moved from doing it rather than every 2 years, doing it every year. Although CFD is not specific to the UK, there are countries, the Netherlands, Germany, all use CFD processes as well. So it's not it's not something that is unique to the UK. Mm. It's a mechanism that helps to get things to the market. The point I was making though is about hydro is that there is no mechanism for hydro. So if you want to build Cruachan 2 today, you don't have a route to market because BEIS have got to create that mechanism. So you have projects which are basically, they could be developed, they could go forward, billions of pounds of investment, potentially several gigawatts of capacity, potentially thousands of jobs that are sitting waiting for a mechanism to be created to allow them to actually start moving. So that's frustrating. That's the type of, if we're going to be clear, and I believe the UK government are clear, that the way in which you deal with the whole issue of the energy crisis in the long term is to decarbonise your energy system, is a greater focus on renewables. The Energy Secretary at UK government level said that. I completely agree with them on that. But when you've got renewable projects that are quite literally fossilising because they can't get a route to market, there's something wrong, which is why we've been raising this issue with the UK government. These are projects that can create both energy capacity, renewable capacity and jobs and economic benefit that we should be doing now, and we should be getting on with it. And that's the sort of thing, that's the type of action we need to see being exhilarated going forward.
No, I appreciate that. I mean, Liam Kerr raised the point earlier about the question of financing, where this money is coming from, and perhaps later on there'll be a couple of questions on budget. Let me bring in Liam Kerr at this stage for additional questions.
Yeah, thanks, Convener. Just on that line of questioning, Cabinet Secretary, you said earlier that nuclear takes a long time to produce and needs a subsidy. Now, the Convener's pointed out the contract for difference regime and the importance of it, but when do you expect the ScotWind programme to be providing 25 gigawatts of electricity?
If the grid capacity is there, potentially by 2030.
25 gigawatts by 2030?
Potentially.
Thank you.
Okay. But the biggest constraint on it is grid capacity.
But
so so the way in which it operates is that if you want to build an offshore wind farm, you also require a date to be set by National Grid on when you will be able to connect into the grid to supply that electricity to the grid. And the biggest risk here for ScotWind is National Grid. National Grid not having put in place the right plans, although they're doing their holistic network review at the present moment, which is welcome, not putting in place the right plans that can then stop a project that could be delivered by 2030 not being delivered until 2035 because they can't get the grid connection until 2034, say. So you need to make sure that you have grid capacity in place in order to deliver these projects. And that's the bit of work that National Grid are taking forward. And the intention is that our view is it should be delivered by 2030, and they're presently taking forward the planning work to look at how that can be delivered.
Let me just ask a very precise question, because I accept the point. I understand the point you're making, Cabinet Secretary, but when do you expect ScotWind to be generating 25 gigawatts?
If National Grid provide the capacity and the planning capacity for all of the projects to be delivered by 2030, then that's when it can happen by. If National Grid don't provide it by then they won't be able to be connected by that point. Right. So you don't build a wind farm without a connection.
Indeed.
So why would you build a wind farm pre-2030 if National Grid say, but you can't get your connection until 2035?
You've thrown the question back to me, and I would throw it back to you that the point is you've rejected nuclear without knowing whether you can deliver on 25 gigawatts. But the point is, just moving on, if I may, Cabinet Secretary, you've just said to Mark Ruskell that demand reduction through energy efficiency measures will offer the greatest opportunity to alleviate increased energy bills. So do you think that the current Scottish Government programmes that you're running will deliver the improvements at the scale and pace necessary to have an impact on consumers by this winter?
I think energy efficiency has got an important role to play, both short, medium and long term. I think it would be unrealistic to expect energy efficiency programmes to be able to be rolled out to the scale and nature that they would need to be in order to deal with the potential crisis we're facing in 2022 and potentially into 2023 with the way the energy markets are at the present moment, just because of the scale of it. Let me give you an example as to why there are challenges there. So there are challenges in the sector because of access to labour and being able to actually do some of the energy efficiency work. I met with a company that's involved in our area-based programme for local authorities in targeting properties which are potentially fuel poor, providing greater energy efficiency, and in some cases providing district heating system, etc. The managing director quite literally said to me, you could double the amount of money that you're offering us for these projects, but we can't actually deliver them. And we can't deliver them because we don't have access to labour. And the specific reason we don't have access to labour is we used to have a lot of Eastern European labour, and we no longer have access to it because we're no longer part of the European Union. Now, I'm not just saying that it's just thrown up for a Brexit reason, but they were quite pointed on it, is that we don't have access to the same labour we had pre-Brexit, which has constrained their capacity and their ability to ramp up some of the programmes that we would like to see them being able to do. So that won't be the case for every company. That just happened to be the case for that particular company. So one of the constraints that you will have is access to labour and skills to deliver some of these projects or to deliver some of these programmes. So you need to take it forward in a way which the sector is able to deliver, and also that you are looking at expanding and developing the skills that are necessary to develop those programmes in future years as they expand and develop as well. But there are constraints, limitations. So it plays an important part in the short, medium and long term, and clearly an important part of meeting our climate change targets to reduce energy consumption levels. But I think it would be wrong to think that just simply doubling the energy efficiency programme tomorrow to double the amount of homes that we insulate could be easily delivered by the sector because of constraints in the sector in itself.
I think that means, just to reflect back, I think that means that the current programmes won't deliver consumer savings to the level required, to the ambition required by this winter. Come back on that point if you want.
Just so I'm clear on what you mean by that. So our investment in energy efficiency, like area-based programmes just now, is largely modelled on what can be delivered in the sector, what we can take forward and where it can be, where there is reasonable grounds for it to be expanded. I'm not conscious when you say that that means we won't be able to meet what we're intending by the end of this year. What exactly are you referring to?
Well, my question was, will it have an impact, the required impact on consumers by this winter, which of course is when we're needing
If you're getting an insulation programme carried out in your property just now, yes, it will. So for those that are already getting insulation programmes or planning to put in insulation and energy efficiency measures later this year, then of course you'll get the benefit of that. But your suggestion that we won't meet a target for the end of this year, what target are you referring to? Because I'm not clear about what target you mean by this winter.
No, I said what I actually said was the Scottish Government programmes. But I think you've answered the question. I'm aware we're tight for time, so I'll move on to a similar programme.
Okay.
Because the UK government that you've brought up several times so far is looking to expand and extend its warm home discount scheme, which would help 280,000 Scottish households with their energy bills. They're going to put an extra £13 million into it. Can you tell us, is the Scottish Government doing something similar to help Scottish people pay their energy bills?
So the Warm Home Discount Scheme is a UK-based scheme. Mm. So we proposed for it to be devolved. It was agreed that it would be devolved. We proposed combining both the Eco and the Warm Home Discount Scheme together to create a more flexible, better scheme. And actually, it would increase the pot of money which was available to support low-income households. And despite, I think, probably about a year plus in trying to get the UK government to agree to that, in February of this year, they finally said no, they weren't going to agree to it because we wanted to expand and to invest more money into the Warm Home Discount Scheme if it was devolved to us. So our plans were, yes, to do that. But we were denied that opportunity by the UK government to do so. When it comes to energy efficiency programmes, as I mentioned, we're putting record investment in over the course of this Parliament in energy efficiency and heat programmes at £1.8 billion. We've also increased the eligibility and the scope of our area-based programmes as well to support local authorities and those low-income households. So we are putting in a significant level of investment, but we remain quite frustrated that the UK government didn't take up the offer and the opportunity to do something even better with the Warm Homes Discount Scheme here in Scotland that would have benefited more households to a better level.
No further questions, convener.
Okay, thank you very much, Liam. We should bash on. We're up against the clock. Let me bring in Jackie Dunbar, please.
Good afternoon, Cabinet Secretary. In a previous evidence session, we heard from Keith Anderson, the CEO from Scottish Power, who gave some compelling evidence. He said that the more we invest as a country in the future of wind and in solar, the more we will bring down the cost of energy and the better and stronger we will make the energy source and security. So can you outline what plans the Scottish Government has to increase offshore wind and what role Scotland has to play in our transition to net zero? And how does that relate to the current energy price crisis?
So in terms of, I do agree with them. So offshore and onshore wind energy is one of the cheapest forms of electricity production that you can have. And you can also clearly tie it very closely to hydrogen, renewable hydrogen, green hydrogen production as well, which could play an important part in helping to decarbonise our gas, natural gas networks as well, which, again, we need clarity on what the timescale for that potentially would be going forward. So in terms of offshore wind, so we have obviously just completed the round one of ScotWind, which has come in at potentially 25 gigawatts of offshore wind capacity between now and 2030, which sees about £1 billion of investment in the supply chain for each gigawatt that is delivered. If to put that in context, if you were to deliver 25 gigawatts tomorrow, which clearly Mr Kerr would like us to do, is that if you were to deliver it tomorrow, it would quite literally double Europe's offshore wind capacity output. So this is massive. Of the 17 projects, 11 of them, I think, are floating offshore wind, which puts us in first-mover advantage position in this area of
technology. So this is you know, a massive level of ambition we're taking forward. And maybe just to give you more context, the USA are taking forward a programme of 30 gigawatts for the USA. So the fact that Scotland, with 5 million people, is taking forward 25 gigawatts demonstrates it, and it's round one. The second aspect is that we've also set out in our onshore wind policy statement that we want to see up to potentially an extra 12 gigawatts of onshore wind capacity being delivered as well. Again, that can help to drive down energy costs because it's a cheaper form. There are also projects that can be taken forward quicker because of the technical nature of onshore compared to offshore wind. And if we can, if we can get more of our renewables online, it can help to reduce energy costs as well, which of course would then have a direct benefit in terms of people's energy bills as well. So our view is that, a bit like Keith Anderson's, is that, and I think in fairness now to the UK government's view, and that is that renewables are absolutely critical to delivering energy security in the future, meeting our climate change targets, and helping to also get down energy costs.
Is it the case that wind power is already the cheapest form of power? Is that what you were saying?
I think onshore is the cheapest form of electricity production that you can now get. Solar might argue with that, and hydro might argue with that, but I think it's broadly in that sphere. So. I think onshore is probably... The reality is, renewables are significantly the cheapest form of energy production. If you compare it, even if you're for nuclear, even folk that are for nuclear recognise it, nuclear electricity is more expensive to produce. Renewable electricity is much cheaper to produce. And that's why our view is that that's where the focus should actually be, because it will help to reduce energy bills in the future.
Okay. My last question is regarding carbon capture, if you don't mind. Would you be able to provide an update on any discussions that you've had with the UK government regarding the Scottish cluster, carbon capture and the storage project?
So we still don't have clarity on the Track 2 process for carbon capture, utilisation and storage. We've had extensive discussions with the UK government on this issue. There's rarely a meeting I have with UK ministers where I don't raise this issue with them. Energy ministers, that is, that I don't raise this issue with them as well. Their view is that it's a matter that now has to be considered in Track 2. We don't have clarity on when exactly Track 2 process will take place. Other than that, the UK government have said in recent weeks that they think they will require, or there'll be four projects, CCUS projects, in operation by about 2030. But the problem is, again, we don't know what the Track 2 process would be potentially for the other two projects to be taken forward, of which I would see the Scottish cluster as being one of them. So we need clarity in that timeline and a clear understanding as to the timescale then for decision making on Track 2 to make sure that it meets with the need to deliver these projects in later this decade.
Okay, thank you. Back over to you, Kevin.
Great, thank you very much, Jackie. Let me bring in Natalie Dawn, who's joining us remotely. Natalie, over to you, please.
Thank you, Convener, and good afternoon, Cabinet Secretary. So I want to focus on an international level. Some of this has been touched on very briefly already in the session. So, Cabinet Secretary, you referred earlier to Canada and Norway, who are dominated by hydroelectric plants and actually do have the lowest electricity prices in the OECD. But looking at other countries too, there's other countries that rely heavily on hydro, such as Switzerland, Austria and Sweden, and consumers pay less in these countries. Across Europe, we've seen governments roll out more generous packages of support for households, and we can see limitations through privatisation in terms of both network costs and the ability to cap prices. And I know you touched on the Public Energy Agency company earlier. So as you've already laid out, many of the levers are still reserved to the UK government. But what lessons do you feel can be learned from looking at other countries' energy policies and how they compare with the UK's response so far?
So I think there's quite a lot in there. So there's a wide range of issues. I think what you can see
at an international level, particularly at a European level, is that there is a much greater focus on decarbonisation of energy sectors and a clear determination to move towards renewable energy at a much faster pace than had been anticipated. You only have to look at the comments and the approach that's been taken by the European Commission and Commissioner Timmermans in terms of highlighting the importance of renewables going forward. Europe's largest economy, Germany, has set its table out very clearly about the about its focus on moving towards renewables and hydrogen as its future approach. So you can see that there is a real step up in pace and desire in moving towards decarbonising energy markets at a European level to reduce dependency on imports, particularly from Russia, and to not only meet climate change targets, but also to deliver security of supply. And one of the things that's been really interesting over recent months, certainly from my perspective, is the way in which countries are now also recognising that in other parts of Europe that they won't be able to meet all of the renewable energy challenges themselves. They're looking for other countries to provide them with potential markets of support. So, I've had engagements with ministers and representatives from different parts of Europe looking potentially at Scotland as being an export market for renewable energy, particularly around green hydrogen, and viewing Scotland as one of the potential main sources of green hydrogen to support the European economy. And to put that in context, a country like Germany that has said that they want to have a big focus on decarbonising industrial processes by focusing on hydrogen will require to import about 70% of their hydrogen. So they'll need to import the vast majority of it, and they're looking for import markets and countries that can support that. So, and Scotland's one of those countries that's in that particular position. So faster decarbonisation, greater focus on renewable energy, countries looking at import markets and also export opportunities because of the way in which there is a focus at a European level to get greater energy security at a European level. And also, I think in terms of actions that could be taken, if you look at the countries that have introduced windfall taxes, countries like Germany, Italy, Spain, have all introduced windfall taxes. And I hear this idea that if you introduce a windfall tax, well, we won't see the investment happen in renewables. Look, before Shell were making record profits, they were already looking to invest in offshore renewables in Scotland in their partnership with Scottish Power. That's not going to change. The fact that renewable investment is increasing in Italy, in Spain, in Germany, despite that, this is just that. It's a red herring. The reality is that investors are still moving into those markets because that's what they want to be, because they see that as being the way in which security of supply will be delivered. So I think the UK government need to act quickly in looking at introducing a windfall tax and to use the proceeds from that to help to support people during what is a crisis that many thousands of households or millions of households across the whole of the UK are facing now as a result of the cost of living crisis, which is just going to get worse.
Thank you. That response is very helpful. Just moving on to a different subject, and again, we touched on this very briefly during the session. Looking at prepayment customers who are obviously unfairly paying more and run the risk of losing their energy supply completely for periods. And it's been highlighted that no one should have to experience this, but we're potentially going to have elderly people, pregnant women, young people, children with no heating at all. Now, more action obviously needs to be taken to protect these people, and I know there's been calls for a social tariff, but that seems to have been dismissed by the UK government. I'm just wondering if the Cabinet Secretary has any further thoughts on what more could be done to protect these people.
So that's one of the specific purposes of the Energy and Security Fund, is to support some of those most vulnerable households, particularly those that are on prepayment meters. We provide some of that funding through the Fuel Bank, who specifically they specifically support people who are in a vulnerable situation with prepayment meters, I believe, to try to help to reduce that risk. And some of it is about providing same-day money to be made available to stop people from self-disconnecting. So, so there's no doubt in my mind that there will be thousands, if not millions, of households across the whole of the UK that will find themselves in that situation on prepayment meters, about thinking about self-disconnecting and just not being able to load up their meter. And that's why I think there is much more we need to look at doing right across the whole of the UK to help to meet the needs of those who are experiencing fuel insecurity. So our £10 million fund is specifically to try and help to meet the needs of those households. But there's no doubt that households right across all of the UK will be facing the same problems, which is why we need to see much more being done to try and help to meet the challenges that these households are facing.
Absolutely. OK, thank you very much. I'll pass back to the convener now. Thanks.
Thank you, Natalie. Let me bring in next Elena Whittam for some questions. Elena, please.
Thank you, convener, and thank you for having me up here at the committee today with my social justice and social security hat on. We've already heard today with regards to the Canadian model of hydroelectricity. Growing up in Canada, I couldn't fail to understand that completely. In my constituency, the Galloway and hydroelectric schemes fed in part by Lough Doon, and it was built back in 1930 and has been happily supplying environmentally friendly electricity for 90 years. 90 years that scheme's been operational. So I just want to contrast this with our very complex system that we have in the UK that really relies heavily on gas. And reports coming out of Sky News today was saying that we're actually in a situation just now that seems rather perverse, that we have a glut of gas in the United Kingdom because we can't actually get it to market. The pipes are working at full capacity with liquid gas trying to get it into Europe, but we have no storage and the system at the moment. So we have those infrastructure issues and pipeline issues. But the fact that the wholesale price has bottomed out and we are seeing people going to be paying huge amounts for their electricity and their gas over the coming months, that seems very perverse to me, and it seems as if it's a system that's not responding in real time to what we're seeing on the ground. How would you respond to that report?
So just so I'm clear on this, are you referring to the fact that there is additional capacity in the UK at produced gas, but we are not seeing the drop in price at a domestic level to reflect that?
Because what we're seeing is the fact that we have the ports, the capacity with the pipelines to actually get that liquid gas to where it needs to be, but it's operating at full capacity and we have no storage capacity.
So we don't have any gas storage. We used to have gas storage capacity, but when the sector was privatised, it was actually quite literally all got rid of, sort of idea. And it's interesting, if you look at some of European countries that are actually putting in gas capacity just now, storage capacity at the moment, countries like Germany, I think the Netherlands might be doing the same as well. So with a view to it being future-proof for hydrogen as well. The reason for that is that you don't see, so if you were to, so my understanding, as it stands at present moment, gas production in UK basins is already at capacity. There is no residual spare capacity that they can say will produce more as well. And even to bring in additional capacity in other fields would probably take a couple of years to do, so it would help us here and now. But the reason, even with the additional capacity in gas in the UK sector, is because it's traded in international markets. So it's international markets that determine the price of it, not a domestic price. So you obviously, we bring in gas from Norway at times. I think we also export some gas as well into mainland Europe as well. So it's all traded. It's an international traded commodity. And it's the international price that set it. So that international wholesale price sets it. So even if you were to say it was an extra 50% capacity you could bring on in the UK sector, it wouldn't have much of an effect on the international markets because it's too small a part of the international sector. And at the same time, it's traded and it'll be the international price that will set it. So it's the reason that you don't see that benefit is because it's traded as an international commodity and it's a wholesale energy price that at an international level sets the price.
I think for people sitting at home who can't afford to top up their meters, to understand that we have that glut of gas at the moment, and it's not reflected in their prices, is going to be something that's very hard to swallow. My final question really relates to something that I've asked the previous panel members when they've been at the committee in the last couple of weeks, is with regard to disaggregated gender data. Now, that is maybe something that you will not be able to answer today, but we know from the Social Justice and Social Security Committee, the evidence that we've been taking from the likes of Engendered and Close the Gap and other organisations is that fuel poverty is very much a gendered issue, that we're seeing, you know, women who are predominantly lone parents, carers or in precarious employment are facing the highest consequences of the cost of fuel crisis that we're seeing. So it's round about the data that the Scottish Government holds with regard to gender and how it's actually creating the policy surrounding this area in response to fuel poverty. Now, that might not be something that you could answer today, but I think it's something that the committee would be keen to hear.
Yeah. I think in terms of, I don't think we've disaggregated data specifically on the fuel poverty side of things. And I don't know whether we have disaggregated data on broader poverty data as well. I suspect we do have that in a disaggregated fashion, and I would broadly expect the fuel poverty data to mirror broader poverty data and the disaggregation of that as well. So I think, you know, if the disaggregated data on poverty shows that women are experiencing greater levels of poverty, which I believe it does show anyway, is that I would expect that to be mirrored in the fuel poverty element of it as well. But I don't think we have data disaggregated in a gender basis for fuel poverty purposes.
I think it could be very helpful if the committee could
be advised.
I'm happy
to take that away and to look at a way in which we could capture that information. We have rurality aspects of it, so we know that those in rural communities are greater risk. But happy to take that away to see if there's something we could do there.
Thank you. Yeah. Thank you, convener.
Thanks very much. Cabinet Secretary, we've covered a number of topics, but I wanted to come back to fuel poverty because I think you mentioned a few times that the Scottish Government has a fixed budget and can't increase spending in the area of fuel poverty. But I've just been looking at the Scottish budget and £500 million of COVID funding coming from the UK Government has not been spent by the Scottish Government. Now, that, as you know, that money is not ring-fenced and is free to be spent in areas of Scottish Government priority. So I guess my question is, why hasn't the Scottish Government used that money to help those in fuel poverty?
So I'm not aware of the £500 million that you're referring to, but if you want to provide me with more information on that, I'd be more than happy to take that away and get clarity on that exactly. Because I'm not cited on it, so I'd prefer to get details on it, and I can then clarify with the Finance Secretary.
Right. It's very much in the public domain, but I'm happy to share that information with you.
If you could now make sure we can take that up with the Finance Secretary.
Right. And then the question then is why, if fuel poverty is a priority, which I'm sure it is, why is that underspend not being spent to help those in fuel poverty?
Well, I can assure you, in terms of my portfolio budget, it's not underspend that we're experiencing. It's certainly not in the Scottish Government. There's an underspend as well. So we make sure that we utilise every aspect of our resource to the maximum of our ability. But of course, we have a fixed budget. We don't have the borrowing powers or the ability to implement something like a windfall tax to bring in additional resource to help to meet what is a crisis that households are facing. Which means that if we take money from our budget from one area and put it into another area, it means we have to stop doing something else. So we are shifting money around within a fixed budget in the same way that most households have to as well. The benefit the UK Government have is they've got much more in the way of levers to actually bring in the level of money and funding which is necessary to deal with this crisis, such as introducing a windfall tax to tackle things like fuel poverty and to be able to provide funding to the Scottish Government that would actually allow us to make even faster progress in tackling these types of issues. So I think if we had greater financial flexibility, it would allow us to take much more effective means, or take forward more effective means to tackle these issues than we have at the present moment. But on your
latter point, the specific point, if you give any details of that, I'd be more than happy to come back with you with the with a more detailed explanation.
That would be very useful, Cabinet Secretary. And as you know, the last year's budget from the UK Government to the Scottish Government was the highest in the history of devolution. So I'm sure there will be interesting discussions with the Finance Secretary as to how that money should be spent. I believe that Liam Kerr has a final supplemental.
Thanks, Convener. Just really on that specific point, Cabinet Secretary, right at the start you said cross-departmental work is going on to recognise the crisis. I've seen reports recently of a number of civil servants being specifically assigned within the Scottish Government to a specific project. Can you tell the committee how many civil servants are specifically assigned to fuel poverty alleviation?
Fuel poverty in the Scottish Government?
Yeah, how many civil servants are specifically aligned to fuel poverty alleviation in the Scottish Government?
I don't have the figures of the civil servants that are involved in tackling fuel poverty off the top of my head, but I'm more than happy to provide you with that information. Many of them will be involved in not just fuel poverty, they'll be involved in wider social policy areas, such as child poverty, household poverty as well. So they won't just work in one specific bit of poverty, they'll work across a range of different areas, because they're all interlinked. So very often those households that are experiencing child poverty are often the same households that are also experiencing fuel poverty. And those who are experiencing poverty in general are very often those that are also experiencing fuel poverty. So the danger is that you work in a governmental basis, which is in a sort of silo thinking approach to it, whereas you need to take a cross-departmental approach to it. So, but I'm more than happy to come back to you with the details of the number of civil servants that are being employed in tackling poverty, including fuel poverty.
Thank you.
Okay, thank you very much. Cabinet Secretary, that brings us to the end of our allocated time. I appreciate we've run slightly beyond schedule, so I appreciate you spending time with the committee and addressing what I think was a wide-ranging discussion. So thank you to you and your officials for joining the committee. I will briefly suspend this public session of the committee before we move on to our next item of business, which is a statutory instrument. So we will reconvene in about 5 minutes' time. Thank you. Welcome back, everyone. Our final item of business today is consideration of the Environment and Trade in Animals and Related Products EU Exit Scotland Miscellaneous Amendment Regulations 2022, SSI 138. This instrument has been made using powers under the European Union Withdrawal Act 2018. The process for consideration of instruments laid under the Act is in two parts. First, the committee must agree whether it is content that the parliamentary procedure designated to the instrument by the Scottish Government is appropriate. I refer members to Public Paper 5 in that regard. I also put on record that because this is an EU exit instrument, we have received a short private legal and policy briefing on the instrument. The Scottish Government has designated the negative procedure for this SSI, and the Delegated Powers and Law Reform Committee was content with this. Are members content that this was an appropriate designation?
Yes.
Yes, we are. We are content with the parliamentary procedure. We now turn to the consideration of the policy behind the instrument. From this point onwards, we will treat this like a normal negative instrument. No motion to annul has been laid. And so I ask members, does anyone have any questions or observations about this instrument or the underlying policy? That is noted. I also ask members to agree to make no recommendation in relation to this instrument. Is that agreed? That is agreed. Thank you very much. That concludes the public part of our meeting, and we will now move into private session. Thank you.